Darn it! Now you got me acting all sappy. There were ghosts in Star House. They breathed softly, silently in the night. One moved through the rooms, restlessly, watching the slumbering occupants in the afterglow of desperate celebration. The house was in shambles. It'd take days to clean everything up and put things as nice and neat as when they'd first entered. The ghost walked quietly amidst the cast-off sparkle cola, bottles, and slumbering ponies. Many virtually sprawled out on the floor, scratching a few precious hours of sleep before the coming day. But not all. Whisper and Stygius curled up together on the couch, oblivious to the outside world. That was how they survived and maintained themselves. They focused on that which was dear to them and shut out the rest of the horribleness. Like this, Whisper didn't need to inflict pain upon the world before it hurt her. There were whispers, squeaks, giggles, and soft sighs of intimate cuddles. And the ghost moved on. Time waited for no pony, not even ghosts. She walked past a sleeping filly, murmuring softly in her sleep from underneath the kitchen table.
8 caps per Spokal Cola bottle, times 48 bottles, 16 boxes of sugar apple bombs, carry the 2.
Carefully, her head was raised, and an old pillow abandoned on the floor was slid underneath it. The yellow filly gave a tiny smile.
5% discount.
That was how she lived. By what the world owed her, and what she owed the world. The door to the room occupied by P-21 and Scotch Tape was open. The pair slept side by side, with P-21 holding her safely in his hooves. They slept the sleep of the secure, the happy, the loved. The ghost couldn't help but smile as she looked down at the pair. They endured simply through being. Through hardship, had battered both. They'd weathered it, father and daughter alike. With caring and concern, he'd given her security and affirmation. She'd given him hope. Next door, in Rampage's old room, Little Pip's friends rested. Calamity snored blissfully next to a Velvet who seemed to have adapted to it. Ditzy's family had refused to stay away there where it was safe. Arriving at the end of the party, Lionheart, Silverbell, and a curious pink-eyed mouse lounged in the wagon, barely visible outside the window. What did ghouls do when the living slept? Did they walk among the sleeping like ghosts, envious, hungrily wistful? Homage laid curled up, her back to Calamity, a pair of headphones covering her ears and plugged into the pip buck she wore. Tears were lingering in the corners of her eyes as she slept. Music, a poor substitute for the warmth of the mare she loved. The ghost ascended. There were others outside who kept watch and would give warning when trouble came. Outside the upstairs doors, barely muted giggles could be heard.
"Want to continue your research?"
Trebana said from within.
"I think that, with all I've learned from Triage, Rover, and Project Steel Pony Notes, I could help ponies all across the hoof. Maybe the wasteland. Cybernetics are a double-edged sword, but if we're careful, the potential for good is phenomenal,"
Glory said.
"If it grants Father vision again,"
Trebana murmured.
"I suppose it's okay."
Silence for a few seconds, and a soft sigh.
"Do you think they could help with my attacks? With some device?" "Maybe. I think so. I'd be glad to find out."
"You didn't have an attack our last time," Glory giggled again.
"I guess I didn't do a good job." "You were wonderful,"
Trebana countered at once.
"Though I'm glad you stopped trying to tie me up. And it was nice to do it without, well, everything."
Whisper often tried to trigger an attack at her parties.
"It was aggravating, unlike this,"
she continued, followed by the sounds of kissing. The ghost rose to leave them to their privacy. Then,
"And you can help Blackjack, too."
The ghost froze, silence pouring out from under the door.
"I know you still care about her. I see the way you look at her,"
Trebana pressed.
"Blackjack, she needs to get through this. I can't be both her special sump pony and come along and help her. She gets distracted, and I don't know And I don't want to compromise her. When everything is all done... When it's all done, then we'll see. Glory said. We have to finish this. I'll do whatever I can so that she can be done and finally take the rest she deserves. And me? Trebana asked in a tiny, barely perceivable voice. You...
Glory was silent for a moment.
You're more than just a rebound, Trebana. I like you. I'd like this thing we have to be more.
A soft sigh.
Blackjack's got the biggest heart in the wasteland. I'm sure she'll understand. Maybe the three of us? Trebana asked. Not you two.
Glory groaned, then relented.
Maybe something will work out. But it'll be tomorrow. Everything will be settled, one way or another, tomorrow.
A soft kiss, a gentle kiss, a rustling of sheets, silence broken only by the longing of the air. Tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. The ghost walked into the last room, gaze sweeping over the cardboard boxes, the desk in the corner which held the IF-88, and the trestled bed. Tomorrow. Time marched endlessly towards the plowing steps from now to the ending of the universe. What folly had it witnessed? What cruelties? What joys? What sorrows? And if the grand totality of the events of the universe were tallied, which would ultimately predominate? In the window, the ghost beheld herself. White, red, black, a blurred panoply. So different from the mare who'd been birthed in the depths of the damned stable, blissfully ignorant of its wretchedness. She'd come full circle, but oh, so much more worn for the passage. Pressing her brow to the cool glass, she stared through the warped and indistinct plane and into unknown darkness. Tomorrow. Tomorrow. What was the price to see tomorrow? And could a ghost pay for the privilege?
Whackjack?
Boo asked behind me. I turned and saw her standing in the door, watching me with wide, scared eyes. Not scared in general. I knew that expression too well. Boo's face showed an odd fear. For me?
You scared?
Me? Scared? I said with a lazy grin I'd practiced so well. No way, Boo. No. I lied as smoothly as ever I had before. But Boo trotted right up next to me, put her hooves around me, and gave me a hug.
It'll be fine, Boo, I reassured her. Uh-huh,
she replied, holding me tightly. Nothing to worry about, I said, now feeling awkward. Easy peasy.
Uh-huh,
she answered again. And once more, I felt myself start to shake. And she murmured,
Don't die, Whackjack.
I'll try my best not to, I started to say, when my voice cracked and I swallowed hard. I'm not going to... Again, that lump in my throat silenced me. Boo?
Don't die first, Whackjack,
she said as she pressed her face into my shoulder. The tremors increased as her words pierced me. Dying first. It was like Little Pip's menthol addiction. If tomorrow didn't go as perfectly as it possibly could, some of us were going to die. Who would be the first? P-21? Glory? Scotch tape? Boo? Any answer other than me tore me to pieces. And that insidious part of myself that had always held me back, which had been... fed by Solemn's own torments, now whispered about how noble it would be for me to sacrifice myself for my friends. Give myself first. Make sure I died first. Then I wouldn't have to see who died next. Lacuna's sad smile filled my memory, and I hated her. Envied her. Nobility, sacrificing herself for others so that her race would have a chance, giving back all the memories that made up her being. How dare she go first? Why couldn't it have been me?
Dying last. Sucked. Was it any wonder Twist ripped the talisman from her chest to save Peppermint? No pony's going to die, Boo, I told her, sniffling. The words halfway between a promise and a prayer. It's going to be just like Little Pip's fight. We're going to go in there, kick some flank, get my body back, and save the world. Just like Little Pip. Boo said nothing. She didn't have to. She just held me tight, because right then I needed to be held. Just two ghosts comforting each other. Then the door swung wide, as if more specters were coming to the party, and for a moment I stared at the darkness on the other side. Then it spoke, low and soft. Don't shoot. The darkness shimmered and dropped, and from it stepped Lancer. He looked horrible, gaunt and exhausted, with fresh scars crossing his striped hide. But he still carried himself with determination. It has been a while, maiden. A bit? Still cursed? I asked lightly. We are all cursed, he answered with a small smile. Some more than others. He turned as he stepped in, and there was a second shimmer revealing Sakashi. A second later, a lump on her back slipped out from under the cloak and onto the floor, revealing Magina. She rushed to me, looking a little better than her son, and embraced me.
I know a funny story about a silly mare who fights great evil, but I fear how the story ends.
Magina tapped her mother's shoulder, waiting for her to turn so she could watch the filly's lips, then took a deep breath and explained.
Well done, Mama. It ends with a psow psow, vroom broom, and then yay. Any other ending would be stupid.
I sure hope so, I said as I addressed the trio. Come to join the fight? My question wiped the smiles off their faces.
No, Blackjack. We have come to take you to the fight, he said gravely.
What do you mean? I asked, a chill running through my mane. She's leaving in a few hours. The three of them regarded each other gravely.
No, Blackjack. She is early. Your copy is leaving within the hour.
Star House filled with yells and shouts as I went from door to door, rousing everyone and shouting for them to get ready. Lancer followed in my wake as everyone scrambled in the panic. Golden Blood entered from outside, took stock of the madness, and immediately relayed to Big Daddy and General Storm Chaser that it was happening now, whether the soldiers at Paradise Mall were ready or not. We were told to take hours to fuel the rockets. That was too dangerous to fill them too soon, I shouted as I checked the drum magazine on the shotgun.
It is not a danger if you force the ghouls to fuel them at gunpoint, and you are not concerned with a few rockets exploding, especially if you can move before your enemies,
Lancer called after us.
They lost two of the older rockets, but the rest are still functional. Father has been generously providing your copy with parts to restore them, and forcing the Popoli to repair them.
Is the remnant still following him? I asked, turning to Scotch tape as I saw the filly scrambling for some healing potions. Make sure they're all good. We don't want to have any get sucked dry by innervation.
Right!
Scotch tape shouted back as she flicked through them one by one, discarding a few that were too pale to be any good.
The remnant has been completely sidelined by the brood. Father has taken them out of the fight, moved our people back to the staging depot for our safety. The few at the launch center were forced to come. I doubt the majority know he is working with your copy,
Lancer said as he followed in my wake. The staging depot was being targeted by Storm Chaser.
Why didn't we have any warning?
I snapped.
Your Pegasi are good scouts, but the brood has cyberpony unicorns with wings. It's impossible for them to get close enough to see,
Lancer said tersely.
Got everything?
Velvet Remedy asked Calamity.
Let's see. Got my barden, got my guns, got my ammo.
He blinked, then looked around.
My hat! Where's my hat?
On your head, Calamity.
Homage said as she checked a Defender disintegration pistol.
Oh, right,
he replied, relaxing.
I'm good.
Do the Legate and Cognitium know this is Blackjack?
P-21 asked as he fell in beside Lancer.
Thankfully, no, Sakashi said. I read their lips through my son's scope. I think that this is a ploy by Big Daddy and his allies to seize power. If you are just a particularly skilled imposter and a patsy to them, they think that you are attacking to kill them and will attack soon.
Does the Remnant know that the Legate is Starkattery? I asked as we stepped outside. My statement didn't prompt shock from the three.
You knew, didn't you? I asked Sakashi.
The mayor balked. There is a story of a mayor whose husband was burned. When he healed, the black marks were as red as blood. She watched him warily, but told her fears to none. Then one night, when she did her duty as a mayor, she asked he remove the skull he wore, for love cannot thrive amidst the bones of the dead. So he did. For his wives, she had the sweetest of silver tongues. What he did not know was that she wore a charm to help see in the dark, and saw his cursed marks. She told his other wives, and they repeated the trick. When they learned what he was, they tried to flee. He could not go after them himself, so he sent him his most devoted son to them.
Lancer had the decency to appear ashamed as he turned away. I was so proud he picked me, he murmured, then looked at his mother for a moment. They shared a smile, and he continued, facing me. I have tried to spread the word, but they are ever skeptical. The Legate serving the stars above, it is more than they will accept.
I hope they change their minds soon, I said as we trotted out. If we were fighting for the future of the world, I hope the Zebras didn't miss out on it because they were blinded by their leaders. Zenith, according to Calamity, was going to try to get Zebras from Glyphmark to come to the fight, but none had arrived yet. Outside, the chaos was rippling like a wave down towards Chapel. No, not chaos. Action. Most ponies knew where they were going, what they had to do. Those that didn't were those who had come to Chapel for sanctuary. The weak, sick, and helpless. You have to get the Remnant to leave their places at the depot and come to the Space Center. If they see what he's doing with their own eyes, they have to accept it. Even if I have to blast that skull off his face and show everyone his marks myself, I said with a frown. So much planning had been done for Cognitium that I had forgotten there was an immortal fighter with scary star powers pitted against me. One that would righteously be pissed off when he found out that I was alive. You've got to get them out of there, though. There's a good chance that, one way or another, the depot is getting taken out, either by Raptor or Megaspell.
Ironic, Lancer said with a touch of bitterness, that the Maiden of the Stars would care more for my own people than our leader.
I sighed and gave him a half smile. You know I made that up, didn't you? All three balked at me in surprise. The whole Maiden prophecy thing? He used it to manipulate people, I said delicately.
My husband may make light of some things, but no Zebra, not even Starkattery, would make up such things,
Sakashi said gravely. The Maiden of the Stars exists, and she will strike down the City of Evil. We thought it was your Princess Luna. Perhaps she may still be. Prophecies may be manipulated, exploited, but they always, always matter.
Even if they are made a monster like my father,
Lancer added. He started to turn away, but I touched his shoulder with a hoof and stopped him.
You are a better person than your father, Lancer. You know that, right?
Lancer blinked, then gave a weary smile.
I know so, but it remains for me to prove it.
I quickly trot them to where Ditzy and Lionheart seemed to be having a heated debate over whether or not Ditzy should remain at Star House. After a brief discussion, I told them where I needed them to take Lancer and his family. Lionheart swore upon the soul of Princess Luna, at thunderous volume, that he could get them there safely. I didn't inform him of where that soul currently resided, but then my ears were ringing. As they left, Goldenblood approached me. Of all the ponies in a rush,
He appeared the most cool and collected.
I feared she might try this. Luna was always full of surprises. And she was sane.
He lifted his pipbuck and checked it, then looked around.
We're going to start operations in 2 hours. There is no way to get you to our forces at the mall and get them moving in time to prevent the launch. It takes time to get 300 mixed murderers, soldiers, volunteers, and draftees in action in concert, even if they're only making 5 miles. We're going to have to improvise.
He paused, and for one moment I saw a crack form on his cool facade.
Blackjack, are you?
I silenced him with a hoof.
I'm not sure about anything, Goldenblood, but I think you're going to be fine. You keep everyone alive, and try to save as many lives as you can. You want to make up for your crimes? Here's your chance.
He swallowed. Then his features smoothed over, as if he hadn't been upset in the slightest.
Of course.
He looked over to where the Alicorn trio were teleporting ponies.
Fortunately, Glory, Stormchaser, and Velvet have worked out a Plan B. It may save all our lives.
Plan Bs are good, I answered. Listen, if everything goes bad, there's a secret weapon I want you to know about. I leaned in, whispering it into his ears, and rewarded with something utterly beautiful. An expression of profound bafflement. Whisper leaned in eagerly, almost bouncing on her hooves, and I gave her a flat glare. No, it's not another mega spell. This time. The yellow Pegasus sighed and rolled her eyes.
Damn it! I miss out on everything!
She said, pouting as Stygius gave her a consoling pat. Goldenblood's face showed doubts.
Blackjack? Are you?
He started to say, but I cut him off with a wave of my hoof.
It'll work,
I said solemnly.
But?
I repeated even louder and with another hoof wave.
It'll work just fine.
How can?
I said, waving both hooves in his face. Trust me, it'll work. I stared at him with such an earnest grin that he relented.
Blackjack,
Glory called from where the trio of Alicorns waited. P-21, Scotch Tape, and Boo all stood there with varying expressions of impatience, worry, and eagerness.
Let's go. The Alicorns are going to teleport us over to the roof of the Luna Space Center.
That didn't seem like such a good idea, given that there were airships, Pegasi, and Flying Brood that would see the flash of our arrival in the middle of the night. But I suppose the ponies who'd planned this were smarter than me. What about Calamity, Homage, and Velvet? I asked, gesturing back at the house.
They'll catch up later,
Glory said as I reached her. Then she held up a harness attached to a backpack.
Put this on.
What is it? I asked as I magically shrugged into it. All my friends, save Glory, were already wearing ones like them. We'd also made sure that all of us had pipbucks and broadcasters like the rest of the battle leaders. Sure, Boo didn't know how to use it, but we could talk to her and find her a little easier if she disappeared. Given all the spare pipbucks in 99, well, I was glad they didn't smell of chlorine.
Something that'll help us get to the roof if Plan B doesn't work,
Glory said. What exactly is Plan B? I asked with a frown.
Alicorns can't teleport you to the general area of the Luna Space Center, since all of our hapless wandering never actually got up there. So, Plan B. It's dark, so the Alicorns will teleport us to a position close enough to use a night vision scope to see where they can teleport us to directly.
She reached down and tugged on my straps, tightening them.
If we can't do that either, hopefully these Earth Pony contraptions will work right. The one we tested did, but don't worry about it, Blackjack.
Don't worry about it? Last time she told me that, I'd woken up half machine. Wait, what Earth Pony contrap? I started to say, as the world disappeared into a purple flash. We were over the Luna Space Center. Way over.
the entire hoof stretched out around me. A great concave bowl with an inky black of the reservoir and the Hoovington River behind us. I could see it all lit by the full moon. I'd seen it before when I was rushing around outside of Star House, but I hadn't noticed it. I was too busy. Not now. There was not a single cloud anywhere in the sky over Hoovington. The trio of Alicorns suspended us easily in a telekinetic bubble as we hovered over a gigantic monolith of a building that was to be the Luna Space Center. It was shaped like a crescent, the points facing west, with sloped concrete walls. The area surrounding the crescent was paved and filled with a complicated tangle of rail lines and turntables, pipes and shadowed trenches, pits and scorch marks. Most prominent were the 6 sturdy concrete pads, a central one circled by 5 others, occupied by towers of metal, 4 floodlit and 2 dark. Each inch of the surrounding terrain was lit up by bonfires, flares, and spotlights, and in 3 places I saw the bulky outlines of double-barreled tanks. 2 raptors, the Blizzard and Zero, circled in the sky, away from the building. Suddenly, I had a deep appreciation for the cesspit that we were all going to be dunked in. Above, the skies were clear and dark, a star shining down at me. The stars. I stared up at them with a sense of wonder. I'd seen the sun and the moon, but peering out in the endless sea of blackness, I could only marvel at their beauty. They seemed to be greeting me. Zebras might think that stars were bad. The Eater of Souls proved that there were truly some. But I couldn't believe that all stars were. Not all of them. So many stars amidst such a blackness. I felt tears on my cheeks. P-21 pressed a forehoof against one of mine, and I looked over at him, seeing a confident smile that made me forget that I was far above the world and snuffed out any fears of splatting before they could form. When Boo took my other forehoof, and Scotch Tape pulled herself along my body into a position across from me, joining her hooves with Boo and P-21, Glory hovered beside me, and I broke my hold on Boo's hoof to make room for her. If only Rampage had been there. Okay, this wasn't so bad. Once all the Alicorns had a decent view of the roof, they'd teleport down. That was Plan B, right? Hard to tell, given what defenses there might be, given how high we were. Well, we just had to move fast. Hopefully, it wouldn't be too tough. Too bad there weren't any blue Alicorns with... Wait. Where were the blues? Had to be some traveling with Velvet. Suddenly, there were flashes far below. Clouds of dust and smoke rising from them. Flares burst to light like harsh artificial stars, and I saw the horde spilling from the edges of the light towards the Space Center. A veritable flood of tiny shapes, I imagined were gangsters, steel rangers, and anypony else with guns barring and a willingness to fight, poured from the darkness. First hundreds and then thousands of attackers. I gaped in shock. Where'd they all come from? If you armed every stallion mare and foal on the hoof, you still wouldn't have that many attackers streaking out in thin streams, firing wildly as they ran. From the silent night came the rumble of far-distant gunfire, then the faint clumps of explosions. I realized I'd seen over 10 seconds ago as the first sign of battle. My blood ran cold. This was suicide, in undisciplined slaughter. As one, the airships and tanks opened up, followed by a deluge of bullets from the defending infantry that would rip the attackers to pieces. How could Big Daddy be so reckless and callous to the casualties of such a charge? Whole platoons of ponies were torn to pieces in their mad charge. Dust cast weird shadows across the open space, and the light danced wildly as they raced along. And still they were coming, more and more, charging and charging and... Wait a minute. I scowled as I watched the endless charge. There was something wrong there. Nobody would ever charge so recklessly forward, seeing the people ahead of them being blown to bits. And looking from above, there was a decided pattern to the rushing soldiers. I focused and saw a distinct bright blue raider charge through a hail of gunfire, disappear in an explosion, and collapse into a crater. 20 seconds later, the same blue raider appeared on the edge of the light,
charged and collapsed into the same crater. I gaped at the nearest olicorn. The green winked at me and smiled. Some of the blues was an Applewood specialist, a special effects manager for the Ministry of Image. We actually planned on using this trick against Red Eye when he turned against us. Her smile faded a little. Never expected one pony would break us. But you're not mad at little... the Lightbringer? I asked. Her expression turned wistful. Some of us are. It's complicated. Mother helped many of us with the confusion. Some are angry while others wish to replace the goddess. But I see it as a second chance, and I have my sister to help me. The other green alicorn smiled as well, rolling her eyes with a snort. Even if she's not as fond of the unchanged as I am. I'm not your sister. I was a 79-year-old granny looking for retirement in a week, she grumbled. You're an intern who shouldn't have been at Mariponi that day. I was trying to score points with Gestalt at my MAS application. I didn't know I was going to turn me into this, big sis, she said with a teasing grin, earning a sour snort from the other green alicorn. Greens, the purple alicorn said with a roll of her eyes. She received a simultaneous sticking out of tongues in return, followed by the older green glaring in annoyance at the younger, sheepishly grinning green. Fascinating as alicornosity was post-goddess, I tried to focus on the fight way, way, way below, while trying to ignore the fact that the ground was way, way, way below. While the air was thin and chilly, I didn't feel as if we were going to pass out. Definitely didn't want to stay up here for hours, though. So if those are all illusions, where are the real fighters at? I asked. Suddenly, the ground at the edge of the concrete exploded in a half dozen places, and sand dogs and earth pony reapers raced out. Two actually emerged behind the brood's lines, and they tore into their flanks with glee. In the gaps between illusions, invisibility spells were drops, and the attackers fanned out into a swarm to hit the brood as they whirled and to deal with the threat on both sides. The tanks disappeared behind cloaks of continuously exploding fireworks. If they were dazzling up here, I wondered how the tank crews flared. From higher up, but further away, two raptors appeared as if by magic. The masked invisibility spell on them tore away by the power of outgoing disintegration cannon fire. If we got through this, I intended to send a bottle of Wild Pegasus to every alicorn I could. Without their magic, we simply wouldn't have been able to do this. Okay, take us in, I said. Cognidium wouldn't wait long before launching with a full-on attack going. There was a flash and a scene shot, short of smashing every atom of my body against a stone wall. Ow, the purple shuddered. I'm afraid we cannot. Can't? What do you mean, can't? Is there a fade shield in the way? I asked. No. Something magical is disrupting the spell, the purple said, pained. Probably some zebra trick, I guessed. Or nasty Starcattery magic. She looked to Glory. Plancy? Wait. What's this? Glory gave a solemn nod. Wait. What's Plan C? I screamed as the telekinetic field holding us disappeared. Good luck, the younger green yelled down after us. Then the three disappeared in a flash. Not that I was particularly paying attention to them at this point. I was a bit preoccupied with how very, very quickly the dark rooftops of the Luna Space Center was getting bigger. The rockets looked like spires. I could see the hard ground and I could imagine myself falling faster and faster till I transformed into a thin paste. I heard laughter and glanced over at Scotch Tape, waving her hooves out to the sides. I'm a Pegasus, she shrieked, barely audible over the rushing wind around my hair. I saw P-21 smiling too, and Boo seeming also at ease. There was only one explanation. My friends were all insane! Then Glory reached behind me and pulled a cord. The backpack flipped open, and a little cloth coming out, catching in the air and then dragging out a giant pink chute. It unfolded and expanded into a round parachute with Pinkie Pie's grinning face emblazoned upon it. P-21's chute opened up, then Scotch Tape's, and finally Boo's. Together, we slowed, drifting towards the great building.
Gory gave me a sympathetic smile as my eyes bulged, my pulse raced, and my mane and tail stood out in every direction.
Nice! They all worked,
Gory said as she drifted down next to me.
I was afraid I was going to have to catch you.
Why didn't you tell me this was Plan C? I asked.
Because you would have insisted on Plan D, which would have probably involved either some horrible attempt to parlay our way in, intruding through some kind of horrible muck-filled pipes, or attempting to change the lines.
Because it was all sane plans! I countered as we drifted down. Finally, though, my panic abated to the point of rational thought. Okay. Seriously, this was genius, but really would have loved trying to talk my way in at gunpoint.
I know,
she said. We continued our slow descent in silence. Fortunately, everyone seemed to be too busy to notice and shoot at us.
Keep your knees unlocked as you roll, and roll when you land,
Glory warned as we approached the rooftop. I wasn't completely abandoned. There were brood squads firing down at the elevated edge. She darted down at the closest one, and just as one of the cyber zebras noticed something and started to turn, opened up with pew-pew. Beams of energy transformed the first three zebras into glittering heaps of blue, green, and red dust. She came a long way from the mare I'd found hiding under the floor. Up close, it was clear that the Luna Space Center had been hit by some heavy firepower in the past. The top was cratered, and at some places, the blast had overwhelmed the fortification and tore great holes through the lower levels. This building was just as tough as Mariponi, designed to take a beating from within and without. But parts of it were every bit as ruined as the rest of the wasteland. Glory had wafted us towards a large intact section of the roof, rather than a hole filled with rubble and jagged rebar, for which I was grateful. This was going to be hard enough already, especially if I couldn't teleport. I landed more or less in a heap, which wasn't surprising given that I had no practice with the unlocking your knees and roll thing. With the battle raging around the building, I hoped our melee here would go unnoticed a little longer. I tried to get to my hooves, levitate up the Iron Pony. I needed to name the damn thing. All badass guns need a special name. And give Glory some support, but the gun was tangled in the parachute canopy, my legs got hung up on the strings, and I fell on my face with a yelp and rough concrete. This is not how I wanted to start this morning, I muttered. Boo charged forward as well, and a frisson shot up my spine. What was she doing? She didn't have a gun or barding. One of the brood turned his guns towards her, and I shouted a warning, about to fire a magic bullet. Then the brood's magazine inexplicably ejected as the automatic gun jammed. Boo dropped and rolled like a log, tripping the brood and sending it sprawling on its face. How? Then scotch tape whipped out from behind some vent ducts and bashed it in the head with a wrench once, and then again.
Got one,
she said proudly, not noticing the two other brood turning their weapons on her. The ground beneath them suddenly exploded, the grenade raising the cyber zebras off the ground with the force of the blast. She whirled as P-21 stepped out. From, well, wherever he usually came from. And grinned sheepishly.
Oopsie.
Tally up when the fighting's done. That one's getting up again, he told her, with a slightly tense smile. The cyber zebra she'd clubbed began to stir, and she pulled out a small baton and jammed it into the base of the brood's skull. There was a pop and a sizzle and a flash of sparks, and it went still. Now you can count it. Soon, the remaining brood in the area on the rooftops were eliminated by Glory's beam gun, Scotch's little shock prod, Boo's utterly baffling little kicks and trips, and two more judicious grenades.
Nice job, Boo, Scotch Tape told her. Where'd you learn how to fight like that? Not fighting, playing. Discord showed me how.
Little statements like that got the oddest looks, but now wasn't the time for elaboration. Glory trot up to where I was still tangled in the lines. She looked down at me with a patient, almost maternal smile.
Blackjack, I broke up with you, remember? Stop trying to tempt me.
I grinned up at her. Hey, I'm nothing if not persistent. She sighed, glancing over at P-21.
He wore a composed mask that barely hid his annoyance. She shook her head.
Talk to me about it tomorrow, Blackjack. Let's just get through today.
You bet, I said, certain that with enough time I'd work something out. Maybe visitation? P-21 during the weekdays and glory on the weekends? I could teleport to Starhouse, to the Citadel, or Skyport. If that wasn't reason enough to live, I couldn't think of one better. And if we couldn't work it out, it would not be for lack of trying. Tomorrow. Now, untangle me? Soon as I was free, we all moved to the inner edge of the roof, looking down at the launch area, embracing the building. I didn't know much about rocket stuff, but it seemed like a clever place to launch from. The high, thick building was a formidable defense against anything smaller than a Balefire bomb or megaspell. Even a Raptor would have to get almost directly above the Space Center to make an effective attack on the launch pads. The gap was the only breach in the defense, and it most likely was heavily protected with a tank in front of it and Brood guarding the tips of the opening. In the middle was the pentagonal arrangement of launch pads with their rockets. The largest and grandest stood on the sixth pad in the center of the Pentagon, a wonder of arcane science and technomagical art. The white metal on its skin bore a tarnished 2 centuries of neglect, but seeing it here so close and in person, bathed in the glow of floodlights and standing next to a tower of girders, pipes, and catwalks, it was still an awesome sight. Unlike the rockets I'd seen in memories and pictures, it had no separate boosters. The hull flowed smoothly down from the pointed nose to the broad base. The other rockets were similar. The less advanced, but still elegant models, with the 4 aerodynamic boosters and launch towers that surrounded and embraced them instead of just standing alongside. Weathered in frigid mist and bearing more signs of slapdash repair. I also had a clearer view of the 2 destroyed pads. One looked as if the rocket and its support tower had exploded and partially melted into a single shard of tortured metal. The other was covered in frost, shattered corpses scattered around its base. Clearly, Goldenblood hadn't been mistaken about the risks of hasty fueling. But where's Cognitium? I asked, trying to pick her out from all the activity. Then I glanced over at Scotch Tape peering through a pair of binoculars. I pursed my lips at her remembering to bring something I'd forgotten, then snagged them from her, ignoring her protest of annoyance. I swept the field with the glasses. If she was down there at all, she had to be near the biggest rocket. Oh, I murmured as I spotted her. Oh, what? Glory asked. I passed her the binoculars and pointed my hoof. She peered through a second later. Oh, my. She passed them to the side, flushing. P-21 took them next, and both his eyebrows arched in surprise, then frowned. He passed them limply back to Scotch Tape. Babu intercepted them and looked as well. At the wrong place, but still she was trying.
Let me see, Scotch Tape demanded. I'm the one who remembered to bring them.
Uda turned them to her, and she stared into the field. Her jaw dropped.
Whoa. Wicked,
she whispered as she passed them back to me.
Yeah, wicked, I said as I looked again.
What had she done to my body? The black armor, based on Shadowbolt power armor, now had more sleek and smooth appearance to it, as if the metal limbs were actually flesh, sinews of cables visible through the metallic skin parted. What actual armor plates remained appeared intricately wrought and ornate, tipped with spikes. The black metal now had a faint purplish coloration to it, and there was no attempt to maintain my old cutie mark engraving or that of the Crusader's filly or security. In place of mane and tail, red and black-striped magic blue, snapping like flame behind her, a crown of brunish silver and rubies rested atop her head. She appeared the perfect amalgamation of magic, machine, and mare.
And so very, very evil.
A small escort of diminutive black and red gun robots flitted about her on levitation talismans, on constant vigil for something to shoot. Suddenly, I had to wonder if just a spark grenade would be enough to take her out. My earlier plan seemed to be quite shaky at this point. Next to her, the Leggett seemed positively ordinary. He still had his hooves wrapped in the glyph-marked cloths, and wore the skull. But those now seemed almost amusing in comparison to Cognitium. I could see Cognitium's lips moving. What were they saying? "Give me a minute," I said as I pulled out the perceptron and jammed it on my head. I entered my old pipbuck tag, and the world swirled away. Not only did she appear different, but she felt odd. This was my old body, and yet not. I could feel the strange, smooth metal limbs far more intimately than I had the old ones, which had been more like phantom limbs. There was a pulse, but it was a pulse of energy. Everything else felt tight and oversensitive. I could now feel the pressure of my baby like a constant sensation, punctuated by slight movements and tiny discomforts.
"Fools have shown their faces at last," the lead was saying. "They don't realize how their factions are already falling apart. The Steel Rangers in Stable 99 are now reinforcing your Harbingers, as are certain Reapers and gangs. Their attacks are a desperate gamble."
She stared down at the smaller zebra stallion.
"When you return the hoof, then all the wasteland will kneel to you." "Be that as it may, we should have gotten word from Steel Rain by now. I dislike that I have so little direct control at this point. Before, when I wanted to act, I simply did. Now I must give orders. It is frightfully limiting,"
Cognitium said in a voice that sounded odd. She sat and stroked a metal hoof idly over her belly.
"I do not like it. But if this is how I must rule again, so be it."
"Are you still determined on keeping those lumps of tissue inside you?"
the Leggett asked, lip curling.
"Do not bring that up again. You serve me, remember?"
she snapped.
"And these babies, my babies. I did not get to have one before. My children will love me. I will raise them, and in time, all of Equestria will be theirs, and the world."
I wish I could see his face behind that skull.
"Well, good luck with that," he said dryly. "You should soon depart, before the raptors get close enough to target the rockets."
"I will leave when I am good and ready. Do not presume to tell me otherwise,"
Cognitium snapped, turning to regard the rockets.
"I will go to the moon once more, alter trajectory, and the core shall be reborn, greater than any ever imagined,"
she proclaimed. "My Harbringers will put down these rebellious subjects, and your puppets," she purred softly.
"I look forward to seeing their faces when I catch this fraud they're calling Blackjack and tear her to pieces before their eyes."
"Of course, O goddess of Equestria," he said as he bowed his head. "And I shall be rewarded,"
he said with a chuckle.
"We shall all get precisely what we deserve."
"Oh, yes,"
she replied, smiling beautifully at him. She turned and flew easily up to the open hatch on top of the rocket, her drones following, where a Harbinger awaited in combat armor.
"As soon as we go, kill him. Then direct my people to stamp out the brood and remnant for good. Hoarfrost and Afterburner have their instructions to assist in the elimination. I will not have him in place with his minions."
The Harbinger saluted and trotted back down the steps. She hissed in annoyance.
"What is Steel Rain up to? He should have checked in on these disturbances in the core hours ago."
She stepped into a small chamber with a dozen reclining seats spaced around the edges, two rings of six each. In the center of the room, two seats surrounded by controls and screens, stopped by a narrow spiral staircase leading down. Instead of pilots, a cobbled-together assembly of computer hardware was strapped and taped to them, with wires running through gapping access panels in the console. A battered ghoul unicorn in a torn and faded flight suit worked frantically on the jury-rigged system, unscrewing another access panel as I watched.
"Are the flight controls ready?" "Soon, soon.
15-20 minutes tops. But it's very risky. These computers ran flight simulations, not actual rockets. He rasped.
No surprise that Cognitium would trust a machine pilot over a pony.
Well, they'd better work. If they don't, I'll teleport to safety, and then I'll come down here and squish the rest of you into undead jam. Do you understand?
Cognitium said sharply. The hovering gun pods all orientated on him.
Yes, yes, they'll work, they'll work.
The ghoul squawked, going back to furiously wiring the machines.
Once they're active, we can signal control room to start the launch.
Good. If you have to launch these things manually, I'll start them with you,
she said dismissively. As the ghoul worked his mouth silently, clearly trying to work out the threat, she took a seat, sitting back and rubbing her shiny black tummy.
I'll save the world for you, my babies. For all my subjects. For everyone.
Then she caught the ghoul staring at her.
Work!
She snapped furiously. I severed the connection. We have 15 or 20 minutes, I said, trying to stem my rage from her talking about her babies. Cognitium was a crazy program with the dead princess's soul jammed inside her. It was my body and my baby. Babies, more than one. Was my happiness doubled or my fear? Both. The baby is okay, I said to P21 as I packed up the perceptron. A relieved smile spread across his face.
What's the plan?
Get to the rocket, get her stunned, swap me in for her, go to the moon and stop Horizons. Easy. Then I looked at the dozens, if not hundreds, of Brood and Harbinger soldiers all over the launch field. Okay, maybe not quite easy. I took a risk and tried to tell
Blackjack, are you okay?
Scotch Tape asked as I blinked up at my friends. Small wonder the Purple Holocorn hadn't been able to teleport down here. No, just teleporting is out. I glanced at Glory and P21. Any ideas? Both of them shook their head. The Scotch Tape said,
Emergency releases!
Suddenly, all eyes were on her, and she balked.
Well, they had to make safeties for fueling. If they had to dump the fuel for a fire or an attack or something, they'd want a way to do so remotely and quickly. If it doesn't have any fuel, it can't launch.
She gestured out towards a large gap in the crescent.
Probably vents way out there.
Scotch, you're a genius, I said as I grinned at the rocket. If we can vent some of the fuel, we'll have to stop and refuel it. Cognitium's not going to risk getting stuck on the moon. And if it doesn't vent way out there, I think it'll provide a heck of a distraction when it all goes up. I was imagining a great geyser of flamer fuel raining down on the Brood forces. We vent the fuel, get inside the rocket amidst all the confusion, take her out with a well-placed spark grenade, or that prod of yours, and then let them refill the rocket and go.
Any pony else seeing the great big gaping holes in the plan?
Glory asked with a smile.
Sure, P21 replied. But when has that ever stopped us before?
Nothing stops Whackjack,
Boo agreed. Where would these emergency releases be? I asked Scotch Tape.
I don't know. But if it were me, I'd want at least one in the main control room, and another right by the launch pad,
the filly said.
I mean, I don't know exactly where, but normally safeties are marked with great big yellow and orange signs, you know? Plus, if we control the control room, that should buy us some more time,
Glory pointed out. We moved out as one, running along the roof to the nearest intact stairwell. P21 made short work of the lock, and we scampered down. Keep an eye out for generators or guards, I said quickly. They're going to need power to run these systems. The more noise and the better the odds are that's where we need to be. Unfortunately, there was an absolute gargantuan building that we were in. It would probably take an hour at least to walk all the way around it. Most of it was simply uninhabited. I could feel the tick-tick-ticking of time. Any minute, any second, We'd hear the roar of the rocket launching, and that would be it. Maybe we could somehow, some way, get the elements of harmony to banish me to the moon. But I doubted it. I kept feeling the temptation to sing, "I am your enemy, come and kill me," so that we'd at least have some idea of a direction. In one large boardroom, we'd encountered heaps of rotting ghouls, some of them still twitching. Presumably, these were the other inhabitants of what I assumed had been Rocket Town before Cognitium arrived. There were disabled turrets, defenses, and melted robots here and there, showing signs of the violent takeover. Then we walked right into the Brood. There were six of them, and as soon as they stepped around the corner, they opened fire at us. Glory cried out as several rounds struck her dragonhide flight jacket, and I felt the familiar thud of impacts absorbing into my operative barding. I didn't have time to wait for an explosive from P-21. I simply levitated the Iron Pony, flicked the switch, and pulled the trigger. The half-dozen Brood were separated into metal and blood, the former falling in sparking, smoking heaps, and the latter splattering the wall behind them, as it was utterly resurfaced by lead. My shooting was shit. I didn't have the little pep levels of telekinesis to control the damn thing, and the most I could do was keep it aimed that way, and I hit that way. In the space of a second, everything in the hall had been obliterated. Six meaty mounds of scrap where they'd stood, and two dozen shell casings littered the floor around me. My Barding's helmet protected my hearing well enough. My friends wiggled their hooves and their ears, trying to get theirs back. I stared at all the casings and the bloody lumps, smoke rising from the barrel. I felt the heat radiating against my face. I lifted the gun before me. "Okay," I said breathlessly. "I hereby dub thee Sexy."
"Sexy," P-21 said flatly. "Really?"
"What? Did you expect something more profound?" Glory asked with a smile. "Hey, I can do profound," I said as I pouted at her. "And sexy is profound. It fucks the target over and leaves them a complete wreck afterwards." "In that case, shouldn't you name it Blackjack?" Scotch Tape said. Suddenly, I, P-21, and Glory were all varying degrees of embarrassed, and she snickered. "I win." Some filly should have been left at chapel. I coughed, desperately trying to regain some dignity. "Okay, full auto was excessive. Good to know." I swapped out the drum magazine and reloaded it first. Sexy was one hell of an ammo hog. It would have been torn up by the barrage that P-21 didn't even try to search them for valuables. He'd need a sieve. Much of the Space Center building seemed to be devoted to the public. We trot through a large museum hall that put the entire building's foundation at the start of the war. No wonder it was located in one of the worst pots in Equestria. Then again, if you were going to repurpose rockets into ballistic missiles, maybe it wasn't so poorly placed. I ran past pictures of ponies testing model rockets in a field, then larger liquid-fueled rockets using alcohol and oxygen, then rockets twice or three times the height of a pony. Another hall seemed to be dedicated to rockets themselves rather than just the history of them. But it was mostly empty. Only models that had been left behind, and a huge hole in the ceiling suggested that some of the rockets on the field had once occupied this hall. I felt a rising surge of panic in my throat. There should have been some kind of massive sign that read "Control Room," or maybe a map with a convenient "You Are Here" label. I was going to fail simply because I was lost. "Boo!" I whirled on the white mare. "Which way do you think we should go?" She blinked her pale eyes in bafflement.
"Blackjack?"
P-21 asked, just as perplexed.
"Just trust me on this,"
I told him as I stared into her eyes.
"Just pick away."
She rubbed her chin and started counting.
"Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Catch a pony by its... that way."
She said abruptly, pointing on the side of the hall that read "Planetarium."
"Blackjack, are you sure?"
Glory asked.
"Shush! Don't doubt Boo,"
I warned as I turned and raced in the direction she'd pointed. I burst through the double doors into a familiarly round room, dominated by a complex projector in the middle. It was almost identical to the one of the collegiate, though perhaps a little bit larger. As my eyes adjusted to the gloom, I spotted an even smaller and more unassuming door with a large sign that said, "Warning, no unauthorized civilians allowed in operations area." "Excellent," I said, patting her on the head as we passed her. The mare suddenly halted, seeming uncertain. I looked back at her. "Everything okay?"
"It's the right way,"
she said as she stared up at the shadows of the great vault.
"Just feels spooky."
"Just keep an eye out for trouble, okay?" I said, keeping my eyes open as we moved through. I understood what she meant, my eyes squinting into the dark pools between emergency lights. Damn, for the first time I really missed not having glowy night vision eyes. "P21, work your magic." We crossed the round room to the far side, and P21 knelt, starting to work with the lock when the double doors we'd entered suddenly slammed shut with a resounding boom, sealing Boo outside the planetarium. One by one, the emergency lights went dark. Almost as one, we clicked on our pitbuck lamps, producing four small pools of wan amber light. Then there was a crackle from the center of the room, and one by one, the projectors popped on, the lights reflecting off the overhead dome in a sickening array of light.
"Ashur," a mare whispered in the dark.
"Dagon,"
hissed a second mare.
"Namtar," moaned a third.
"Nibiru,"
said a final, lighter voice. In the pale light, four cloaked figures stood on the periphery of the room, three adults and a foal, growing by size. Given that they were wearing cloaks and spoke the names of freaky stars that made my mane crawl, I lifted Sexy to the closest of the four. It swung its hoof, and a pale blue streak of dust crossed the distance, coating the weapon. An instant later, an inch of ice flashed into being around it, transforming the firearm into an icy doorstop.
"The Black Star Ashur's cold embrace overcomes your weak technology,"
the mare said as we drew back her hood. The old zebra's mane, stripes, and eyes were almost fading to nothing. Elsewhere in the line, the smallest of the four took a piece of paper and dangled a crystal over it. Glory snapped her gun down at the old zebra, but one of the others tossed a hoofful of crimson dust in the air. The cloud twisted and formed flaming serpents that streaked towards Glory and chased her around the projector.
"Do you think we'd overlook your plans, little pretender? The stars warned us of your attempt,"
she said as she pulled back her hood, showing a mare whose face was a mask of stubborn, burn keloid, on which circular tattoos stood out as clear as day.
"Dagon shall consume you."
"I don't have time for this," I shouted as I pointed my horn at the cold zebra and fired a volley of sats-guided bullets at her head. The filly let out a yell of alarm.
"Block!"
Another hoofful of blue dust slashed through the air a moment before its volley hit, and she'd been expecting it. A thick wall of ice deflected each of my shots away. I stared at it, then at the filly. He gave a little smirk that said, "What are you gonna do about it?"
"We have eternity and more,"
intoned a third, then looked at the filly.
"Where is he?"
she said in a voice like tar. The filly, not taking her face off the paper before us, pointed her free hoof over at the left. The elder mare snapped her hoof, the green dust whipping out like a comet, condensing into an orb of energy. It exploded with a bright rainbow-green flash, revealing P-21 with a grenade in his hoof. All our pitbucks began to crackle madly at the radiation. The ghastly illumination showed a mare's features, which appeared distorted like soft wax.
"The stars wrought for eons, and you shall join them. Namtar demands it."
As my horn recharged, I tried to close the gap with the old zebra, but her funky blue dust kept stopping me. She turned the floor under me to slippery ice, sending me sprawling on my face, and dropped jagged frozen spurs the size of my hoof down at me. Fortunately, my telekinesis deflected them. Little Pip would have just rammed them right up the zebra's ass. Glory was still busy dodging the seeking snakes, while the green one calmly kept trying to blow up P-21. Scotch tape blinked to the three adult zebras, then charged the only one her size. Without looking up from the paper She jerked it aside at the last minute and scotch tape, sliding through the empty air.
Hey, you! Fight me!
Scotch demanded.
Ain't you got spooky star stuff to spout at me?
Yeah, yeah. Nibiru curse you, whatever.
The zebra said, putting back her hood enough to reveal a filly of the same age. I was taken by how pretty she is for her age, despite the arcane markings on her delicate face. Even scotch tape gaped for a second.
Busy now. Don't ignore me!
Scotch tape yelled, her cheeks flaming, diving at her. Once again, without looking up, the filly kicked back, planting a hoof upside Scotch's head. Scotch fell back, holding her head in her hooves, bit down on her wrench, and dove once more, swinging wildly. The little zebra thrust out her rear legs, embraced herself against Scotch's head, holding the olive filly at bay as her mouth swung and her forehooves thrashed in the air.
Gonna beat you!
Told you. Busy now,
she said. Then she looked at the old zebra.
Aropos, the signs don't make any sense. This may not be the maiden, but Nibiru is going nuts here. I do not know who she is, but she is not a no pony.
She shoved Scotch away, her cloak flipping up and around her shoulders.
And this one isn't helping,
she snapped as she kept scrying the paper.
And stop staring at my butt! Focus on the here and now. Not now, Pytha,
the old zebra rasped.
Finally, we will be ascended after 10,000 years!
The scarred mare laughed as she tossed more incendiary powder up at Glory. With the flames seeking glory under their own enchantments, the burned zebra was free to dance away from any of Pew Pew's beams that happened to get near her.
We shall rule this world as our own right!
The exploding green dust kept B-21 moving around the perimeter of the room. If he got much closer to us, he could have risked us being caught in the baleful green explosions. Worse, the one time he moved closer to the old zebra with the ice, the fillies snapped out a warning, and the old zebra whirled and covered him in a layer of hoarfrost, while the mutated zebra nearly blasted me off my hooves.
Kill them,
she said as she flung another hoostful of green dust.
I'll feel better when the Maiden of the Stars is gone forever.
P-21 launched a grenade at her, but she detonated it in midair with more of the damn magic dust. I focused on the old icy zebra.
Forever? That rocket's coming back, you know!
I yelled at them.
And a Balefire missile stands ready to greet her the instant she lands.
The one flinging red dust cackled.
One specifically treated with our magics to disrupt any pitiful pony shield talismans she may try to defend herself with. She will be vaporized before she even realizes it was used. We shall rule forever,
the scarred zebra crowed.
Shut up, Uredale!
Snapped the mutated Balefire Dust Zebra.
Stop playing around! You're making basic mistakes!
But what the burned mare had said nearly halted me in my hooves. The Legate had a Balefire missile? Of course he did. Xanth had told me about that warhead, and he had the remaining missiles from Grimhoof. It made sense, too. Once Cognitium had fixed Tom's trajectory, why risk combat with her? Let her come back triumphant and be vaporized as soon as she landed. Not even a cyberpony could survive that.
And so who's going to rule? Which one of you gets to call the shots?
Glory called out.
Why, all of us together,
the old zebra chuckled.
Of course, the Legate gets to sit on the throne, and we will be the ones that actually get things done, and reap the benefits. Isn't that the way it's always been with powerful males?
The littlest one kept struggling to focus on the paper and keep Scotch tape at bay. It'd be impressive if it wasn't so pressing for time. She never took her eyes off the sheet before her, nor dropped the dangling pendant. Even as she dodged, sidestepped, backflipped, and pirouetted around Scotch's wild charges.
That isn't right, Celia. I'm seeing shadows of the future. Something is wrong.
Scotch tape tried to get her hooves around one of the filly's hind legs, and the filly barely yanked it away in time.
And would someone get her off me? It is hard enough to scry in the middle of a battle without this one distracting me.
She kicked back and nailed Scotch in the face again, sending her staggering back across the floor to trip and smack her head against the base of the projector.
Fine, the mutated Celia said. Then turned towards Scotch and lifted a hoofful of powder. I'll remove the distraction, then. Petronuan, who already had a glowing ball of star magic sailing towards him, suddenly turned and launched himself at it. He rolled tight in a ball and hit the glowing dust as it started to flare, scattering it and forcing it to reform a second later behind him. The blast launched him straight into Celia like a cannonball, smashing them both to the ground.
Ha! Now who's the one making rookie mistakes? Iridale crowed,
and then she threw an enormous wad of red powder into the air. The heat had set her mane on fire, but she didn't seem to notice as she laughed, the airborne dust igniting into the shape of a dragon, glowing larger and larger and filling the ceiling.
Fly! Fly! Fast as you can! There is nowhere to run when all is aflame!
She laughed madly. The billowing fire caught Glory, and she covered her head as she tumbled towards the ground, feathers and tail ablaze. A moment later, there was a pop and a hiss as water poured down from the ceiling sprinklers. The dragon roared in agony before melting away, and Iridale shrieked as her glowing red powder suddenly became so much dull red mud.
No! No!
She cried as Glory rose to her hooves. Beam gun clenched in her jaws. The zebra flung globs of the soaking powder at Glory as she approached.
Dagon! Dagon, burn her! Burn them all!
She teared up as she stared at the red goop running down her hooves.
Dagon, why have you forsaken me?
Glory gave the burned mare a shooty look, and I wondered if this was going to be it. Was she going to become an executioner? Iridale pouted, scooped up balls of red muck, and watched them dribbling away. She sat in a red puddle.
Go away. Dagon will burn and consume you. He shall burn all the world to ash for daring his right.
Glory's gray feathers were blackened and bent, her mane scorched and her face distinctly ready to dust the zebra. Then she lunged and smashed her hooves against Uridale's head twice.
Shut up!
She snapped.
Arpas,
the filly wailed.
I can't see anything but shadows now. The stars won't show me anything.
The old mare said something in a voice that chilled me to the bones. The blue light struck the floor, a ring of frost flashing out from her. It ran up the walls and across the ceiling, covering everything in ice. My friends and I were glued to the floor.
Enough, she growled. This is over.
Overhead, four long spears of ice started to form. I can tell you why you can't see the future, I said simply.
Doubtful,
she said grimly. The Legate is going to resurrect the Eater of Souls, I informed her. There's nothing quite so funny as seeing an old person surprised.
Let me guess.
The Starkadari were going to rule the world, right? Brood, core, making pony and zebra alike bend to their hooves. For you? Goddesses. It was Cognitium's routine. Just a different audience.
He's not.
He's going to resurrect the Eater of Souls, and everything's going to die. You, me, but not him.
He can't die, right?
Arpas scowled thoughtfully, those lances of ice growing longer and longer.
You know nothing of what you speak. The ritual to do so would require hundreds of my tribe, and we are all that remain. We five. We could never call down a star, nor would we be foolish enough to try a second time.
You don't have to, I countered. The Eater of Souls got a pony to bind a star to the stone that Cognitium is sending straight into the core. Again, that satisfying look of shock, though it wasn't as funny a second time around.
Arpas, the small one said. I'm seeing a gap in the shadows, but I don't know why.
She stared at me.
Who are you?
Hush, Pythia,
she growled, regarding me. At least the icy spears had stopped growing.
My people have never loved the Eater of Souls. We sought to use him for our own empowerment, for he is a vast source of power. We summoned a star once at his direction, and the reaction nearly broke the world in two. At the last moment, my ancestors broke their ritual,
letting the star escape. But the devastation was complete enough to eradicate our empire from the earth. We are born with this brand as a reminder of that folly.
She gestured at the orbital markings on her face. The Legate's lying to you. Maybe there is some way to restore the core without setting the Eater free. I can't say that it's impossible. But I can tell you that he's not interested in anything, ruling anyone. I pointed at the filly. She can see the future, right?
Well, can she see a future? Any future? Where all of you get exactly what he promised?
Now that all eyes were on her, the filly stammered.
There are shadows. Always shadows. Just because I haven't seen it doesn't mean it's not there.
Maybe.
She faltered. She looked down at the paper, which, now that I was frozen in place, I saw was a map of the night sky. She dangled the crystal, the gem making tiny pinpricks of light on the map.
It has to be here somewhere, right, Arpos?
Arpos narrowed her eyes at me.
You. You're not a copy, are you? You're her. Actually her. The gambler.
She smiled a little.
You're supposed to be dead.
Yeah, I'm really bad at that, I replied. Has Amadi said anything about what you're actually going to be doing in his glorious future? Made any real plans past restoring the core? Anything besides promises? Arpas was lost for a long moment, staring at me contemplatively. That I could have screamed.
I had a deadline here.
No, I suppose not.
She stomped a hoof once, the old mare suddenly seeming a lot more tired and haggard. The ice shattered into snow. Scotch tape gave the filly a dirty look as she walked a trife unsteadily to where P21 had landed.
It would have been nice not to see my tribe go extinct, the mare said quietly, turning away from us. Uredale, Cilia, Pythia. Let us go.
Wait, I said as I turned the frost off my barding. You need to tell the other zebras.
Tell them. I'm not sure if you've noticed, but our tribe is cursed.
Stupid pun,
Uredale said with a sneer, then saw Glory's angry glare and shrank back. Her mane, tail, and feathers were badly scorched, but the jacket seemed to have protected the rest of her. Lancer, Sakashi, and Majina are trying to convince the tribe that the Legate is a Starkattery. You have to help them, I begged. Okay, I wasn't exactly sure how that was supposed to work, but still. Help was good. They wanted to show everyone they were good, right?
Apros regarded me coolly. We will think about it. And if Pythia sees our glorious future, we will come back for you. But for now, we shall withdraw and consult with the stars.
One thing,
P21 asked as he pulled himself to his hooves with a pained expression.
Why does the Eater of Souls draw in pony souls but not eat them? And that's never made sense to me.
Arpos regarded him with surprise, and I had to admit I did too. After all, as long as we weren't dealing with slavers or the like, P21 never really seemed interested in who we were fighting or why.
The Eater eats the souls of the stars. It collects the souls of lesser beings to sing its praises for all of eternity. And when the Eater has consumed all the light that remains, the souls of all life will exist for nothing but aggrandizement of its own ego. Naturally, any sane.
And here she eyed the scarred and charred Uredale, who was intently poking a ball of mud and whispered loudly,
Dagon will burn you,
with every jab, and heaved a sigh.
And many not-so-sane zebras, Starkattery or not, know such a fate is punishment without end.
Right, I said. Well, if you want to avoid that, try and help us. We need everyone, even you. The comments seemed to give the old zebra pause.
Interesting. You are unsettling. I see why he fears you so. As I said, we shall consider it.
She turned and led the other three towards the exit. Wait! The filly ran up to us holding scraps of paper with some numbers scribbled on them. Here, the brood guard patrols. Just take cover at these times and they should miss you. She gave a little smile and ran for the others.
Wait for me! I have never been so humiliated, Scotchtape groaned,
rubbing one of the many black and blue hoof marks that now covered her face.
She spent the entire time staring at that map, and I didn't lay a hoof on her!
She stared in the direction the filly had gone. Especially not her rear, I added with a smirk. Scotchtape glared at me as she replied in icy tones.
Yes, especially not that.
She stared at the door.
Enemies aren't allowed to be cute like that.
Zebras are just like that sometimes, I said, trying not to think of Lancer atop me. I tried my broadcaster, but only got static. Apparently, magical jamming wasn't the only source of interference here. I trotted to the entrance and kicked the doors open, looking for Boo. Nothing. I spotted her pipbuck tag on the other side of the room and frowned, trotting to the small access door. Boo appeared in the doorway as soon as I'd gotten it open. She rushed forward, hugging me tightly.
I'm sorry. I should have known something bad was in there.
It's okay, I said as I patted her mane. How'd you get over to this side, though? I asked with a frown.
Oh, well, doors was locked, so I found the right way.
She beamed up at me.
Ready to go?
We only paused long enough for every pony to share a round of healing potions, and I was glad to see the plumage on Glory's wings grow back. P-21 also drank heavy doses of rat away. Celia's powerful explosions had been like mini balefire bombs. For all I knew, that green powder was what balefire eggs were made from. We'd fallen behind in the fight, but with Boo leading the way, and Pythia's little scraps of times, we were able to take cover seconds before the brood came trotting into view. Not that we couldn't take them. I had thawed out my gun and checked it, and the rugged thing seemed to have come out okay. It was a little unsettling, though. Every time the moment came close, we'd take cover with no sign of the brood. Then they'd come around the corner and out of a door and just miss us. Note to self, seeing the future is useful against your enemies. The operations section of the building was relatively small, but given the enormity of the building it was in, it still took us far longer than I was comfortable with getting past that many brood patrols. A wave of relief swept through me when I spotted the door marked Launch Control ahead. Sexy roared out two hammering storms of buckshot, shattering the brood guards long enough for P-21 and Glory to finish them off. I looked at the shells scattered on the floor around me. Even on burst instead of full auto. Some pony's a cartridge hog. I chided the weapon affectionately, then stormed through the door. The control room was much, much smaller than I'd anticipated. I'd expected a cavernous space with tiers of hundreds of terminals, maybe a massive holographic display floating in the middle. The somewhat underwhelming reality, a dozen terminals on ordinary desks looking out at a window angled down, and curved to give a slightly distorted view of the entire launch pad. A number of little displays above it showed the various rockets. A half dozen zebra technicians sat at various terminals with two brood unicorns standing guard. At the sight of me, bursting in, the former scrambled under or behind their desks, and the latter opened up with bolts of lightning from their dark metal horns. I jumped back into the cover behind the door frame, electricity sizzling past me. P-21 threw in a shock grenade, but I shook my head. I had no idea what those controls did. I didn't want to launch the rockets by accident.
We require reinforcements,
I heard one of the true broodmares say with a robotic monotone of Silverstripe's voice.
What? You can talk?
I gasped.
Brood can't talk!
Auto communication feedback protocols enabled, they replied dryly in unison.
One of the zebra technicians began to creep towards an intercom panel on the wall, looking quite hesitant to do so.
Expedite, they urged.
not taking their eyes off the doors as their horns glowed. I could almost feel our time slipping away. Then Glory launched herself out of cover and through the doorway, her beam pistol already spitting rainbow light. The brood were turned into sparkling dust, but not before one of them hit her hard enough with a bolt of lightning to send her slamming against the hallway wall. I rushed to her as P-21 and Scotch Tape swept into the room, shouting at the technicians. The filly tackled the zebra at the intercom, throwing her forelegs around his neck and chomping on his ear. I practically shoved a healing potion down Glory's throat, then unzipped the jacket and pressed my ear to her chest. "Don't be dead, don't be dead, don't be dead," I whispered over and over again. I heard the beat of her heart.
"Don't you have a world to save?"
she muttered. I lifted my head and saw her sad smile.
"You know you're better off without him."
She smiled quietly. "Let me decide that. We're all getting through this. And then I'm going to work things out if it kills me," I promised as I stroked her cheek. "I still haven't given up on plans of making it all work out between the three of us."
"You never give up,"
she murmured with a shake of her head, then zipped the jacket back up.
"Tomorrow,"
she promised. Then we heard the rapid approach of more brood, and I ran into the launch control room. Boo peeked down the hall and suddenly threw herself against the wall as a burst of gunfire spat at her. She rolled across the floor back into the room.
"There's a whole lot of them coming. Zebras and ponies, too."
P-21, I said quickly. "Persuade them to take their time. Scotch, see if you can lock that door or something." I looked at the haggard, terrified zebras. "Propoli?" I asked, startling them and getting wary nods. I clasped my tire hooves together.
"Okay, time is short, and I don't want anyone to die. First off, I need to delay the launch. Is there some zebra here who can help me with that? Maybe do an emergency fuel venting or something?"
"Are you trying to get us all blown up?"
one zebra in huge blue glasses asked.
"That's a terrible idea."
"Congratulations, you're the leader," I said as I trot over to him, trying to ignore the explosions in the hall behind us. "Listen, I need to get out there. I need to get on that big, fancy rocket. Tell me how to do that," I said as I stared into his eyes with a casual smile. He kept gaping from the window to me.
"What's your name?"
I asked.
"Cernitis," he said unsteadily.
"Cernitis? I'm Blackjack," I said as politely as I could and patted his shoulder. "I've told you what you needed. You can tell me how you can get me to make that happen. Can you just delay the launch from here? Wait till I've got everything taken care of and then send me off?" When he didn't answer, I pointed my gun at the terminal. "If not, I'll have to just start breaking things, seeing if that works. Or try that emergency fuel dump idea." He swallowed and adjusted his glasses.
"Please don't. This facility, it is a miracle it's held up as well as it has. If it wasn't for the ghouls that used to live here, planning to escape to the moon or some such, I doubt it would have at all. Still, it is in rough shape. Most of the rockets are barely restored, literal museum pieces. I doubt half of them will make it to the moon, even if they launch successfully. If you start venting the fuel or an oxidizer, then there is a good chance the system will channel it safely. A way won't work. The loading systems are probably leaking some as we speak. So many of the sensors aren't working that I cannot be sure of that."
He ran his hooves through his bristly, erect mane, then waved over his head.
"I tried to explain to them, but it was reckless. But they would not listen to me. Rocketry is supposed to be a calm, focused, deliberate use of technology, not slapping things together, filling them with explosives, and just hoping they will work."
"Eh."
I gave a minimalist shrug. "Then help me out here. How can I slow things down?" I spotted Glory examining a nearby terminal.
"We can keep the other three rockets from launching," he said, pointing at clocks which were frozen at 1 minute. "Even if they overrode the controls and manually got the launch towers down, they didn't have the time or training to fire the boosters locally without destroying the rocket. But there's nothing we can do about the one in the center. It is an ESSA-1,
the only one ever built before Equestria's space program lost funding for any new ships. This is the finest MTRPG engines ever designed, with a TWR of...
I'm a technological moron here, I said as I smiled at him. Just tell me how to stop it from launching. His mouth worked silently for a moment, as if trying to figure out how much to dumb this information down.
Really?
Finally, he said,
sorry, you can't. The erector has already been locally disengaged. The launch tower isn't sturdy enough to be a problem for the rocket, even if it stays in place. It's mostly just to make cargo and passenger transfer easier. The ESS A1 can launch and land pretty much anywhere with flat ground it won't sink into.
That was not what I wanted to hear right now. The doors shut, and there was a thump against them. P21 stepped back, bobby pin in his mouth from the door.
Okay, Scotch Tape said. Daddy locked it, and I think I got it jammed. It still won't take them long to get through, though. For all I know, they can chew through it.
Not unless they can get it in their mouths, I replied with a smile, then turned back to the zebra. Well then, keep the other rockets here. If I can't stop her, I'll need a rocket to follow her.
Be careful. There are magical fields that activate prior to launch. If you get stuck inside when the rocket goes up and don't reach a bunker, you'll be cooked, he warned. You'll only have 10 seconds between the fields going up and the engines firing, and that's if everything works properly.
Plenty of time.
If I were to teleport, damn it. Now, for the last challenge. How do I get out there? If you said I couldn't, that big window was going to have a date with Sexy on full auto with grenade chevrons. Thankfully, he pointed a hoof at a hatch set into the room's exterior wall. I rushed over, twisted the handle, and yanked it open. Behind was a 6-foot-long hall, ending in what looked like a sturdy exterior door.
I should stay here, Glory said.
I rounded on her. What have we learned about splitting up? I told her. No, I want all of you with me. No one gets left behind.
Some ponies should stay, P21 said, examining the door. That won't keep the brood out forever. I could do it.
No, you couldn't get back in time,
Glory said with a shake of her head.
I've got a strong enough weapon to stop them. Plus, if you do need to launch one of those other rockets, some pony's going to have to push the button and fly you up before it crashes.
She patted my mane.
Don't worry, Blackjack. I might not be Dash anymore, but I can reach you in a minute.
How did I not like this? Let me count the ways.
Blackjack,
P21 said gravely behind me.
I'll be fine,
she said as she stroked my mane. Hurry, you don't want to miss your flight. I closed my eyes, feeling her hoof as it brushed my cheek. Tomorrow, I murmured.
Tomorrow. Till then, do what you do best. Go,
she said, her hoof lingering a moment longer. Then she pulled it away. I didn't trust myself to wait any longer. I turned, stepped into the hallway, and told the zebra over my shoulder to show her how to make the rockets launch. And then Glory closed the inner door behind us. The outer door opened into a stairwell that ran down along the inside wall of the crescent.
Sorry my plan didn't work like I thought it would, Blackjack,
Scotch Tape said, apologizing from her father's back as we hurried down. Hey, no sweat. If you could guess the inner workings of rockets a few months after getting your cutie mark, I'd feel really gypped. They touched the ground between the concrete pads with faded stenciling signs that read 5 and 1. Closer to 5 than 1. Large gates covered dark pits that I guessed were for redirected rocket exhaust. A ring of talismans gleamed around each of the pads. Arcane Bulwark, do not stand on line, was written repeatedly around them. And in several places in each ring of talismans were pits with stairs leading into them, and signs reading emergency shelter. The pit seemed nearly full of water, but I couldn't make out more than that. At the bottom of the stairs, I looked around at the others, and then put a hoof around Boo. Boo, I have a super special mission for you. She blinked at me. Do you feel up to it? Boo's face grew more serious. You need to find Big Daddy, or Lancer, and tell them that there's a Balefire missile aimed at this place. They need to be ready to pull back as quickly as they can. We're here. At this point, I'm not sure how much good they can do with our attack.
You're sending me away again,
she pouted. Because you're the only pony who can make it. I know you're lucky and smart and quiet. I gave her a kiss on the forehead. Give them to it quick. I reached down and manipulated her pipbuck, typing out a brief message. Balefire bomb targeting space center. Get out. Do better. Blackjack. They didn't think I'd send her. Well, there wasn't much I could do about that. Boo moved away, paused to gaze longingly back at us, and then sped out into the shadows around the side of the building. The rest of us quickly made our way past the smaller paths towards the center. Cognitium's rocket was a shining white tower curving gracefully up to a point high above us, reaching for the stars. A scaffold tower rising next to it, allowing access, and looking quite utilitarian in comparison to its neighbor. Get your spark grenades ready, I said as we approached the base of the scaffold, where a stairway and several cargo and passenger elevators stood empty alongside large wheels that must have been for moving the tower away from the rocket. Cognitium! I roared up at where I knew the control room hatch was. I'm calling you out! Get down here and give me my body back! She'd do it. She was arrogant enough to do it. She would just want to squash me personally. But then a worried thought struck me. You can hear me, right? I hollered up at her. Hey! Hey! I started jumping up and down, waving my hooves in the air. Get down here! I really did not want to fight a flying me on a scaffold 10 stories in the air. And the brood were coming. While most of them were occupied fighting our allies assaulting the facility from the room outside, there were still plenty left to deal with us. I looked around and spotted a box marked Intercom 6 by the base of the launch tower stairwell, rushed to it and mashed my hoof against the button. Cognitium! There was silence and then her voice crackled over the intercom. Who is this? You know who. You took my body and my baby. I want them back, I snapped. Your baby? Cognitium murmured. Her voice took on that purr that nearly made me bite the box. It is you, isn't it? How interesting. She took on a note of delight. I want my body back, and I want my baby back. And how is it to want? I wanted a body and my kingdom back for 200 years. I dare say I'm handling it much better than you are now. And let's be honest, I'm going to be a much better mother to my babies than you ever will be. There was a pause. Did you just bite the intercom? I wasn't going to answer that, no matter how much my teeth hurt. I'm going to stop Horizons, I said as I saw the brood coming closer. Face me. Face you? Dear Blackjack, I have a world to save. I don't have time to indulge you, she said sulkily. However, I will make you this offer. If I return and the Legate is dead, I'll pardon you and your friends. I'll allow you a quiet life elsewhere in the world. The Legate has fooled you, I shouted. There's a star spirit bound to Tom. The Legate is planning on feeding it to the Eater and resurrecting it. You're playing right into his hooves. You are deranged, Cognitium said disdainfully. The Tokomere will be restored and the core rebuilt, and we shall proceed to a glorious future. Too bad you are so mired by the past. Suddenly, klaxons were blaring, red lights flashing on the scaffolding tower as it pulled away from the rocket with the grind of protesting machinery. Clear pad 6 immediately. Launch pad sequence initiated, a recorded voice began announcing, as the ring of bulwark talismans grew brighter, and a hiss began to build in the darkness beneath the rocket. Clear pad 6 immediately. Rampage! Stop her, Rampage! I know who you are. She's never going to help you. I screamed into the intercom over the noise, having to trot to keep up with the moving tower. Dealer! I know you can hear me. You owe me, dealer! Still no response. In my rage, I lifted my gun and pointed it at the rocket's thick base. P-21 tackled me, breaking my focus.
No, Blackjack. If you get through the hole at all, you can blow us all up. Come on.
No! Damn it! I shouted as he shoved me back towards the line of bright talismans. I'd been so sure she'd face me personally, that I'd do it and get it back. No! I yelled as we crossed the bulwark. He held me back. Then a shimmering field rose up, flickered, and solidified. Smaller ones rising around each of the trio of exhaust grates. I pushed past him, hammering on it with my hooves, the magic flashing as I beat something with the consistency of thick rubber. Then the ground leapt under my hooves, shaking so much that we nearly bounced across it. The flames under the rocket were tiny, pale things with barely visible columns of exhaust, with an odd diamond pattern in them. But the sound that managed to escape the field was deafening. From the exhaust grates blasted huge columns of steam, jutting out into the clouds. At the tops of the exhaust bulwarks, they didn't beat the rocket so much as shot it up. Its own bulwark, taller and still low enough that, when it finally cleared the top of it, the building noise nearly ruptured my eardrums and the hurricane blast of suffocatingly hot gas that escaped around the sides of the field picked me up from the still vibrating ground and sent me skidding past another waiting rockets and towards the wall of the Space Center. When I came to rest, I was surrounded by a stinging hot fog, the roar of the rocket's engines growing quieter and quieter, and making my ears ring from the relative silence. I lay on my back and stared up at the now hidden sky, my ears trying to track the rocket and my eyes desperately trying to see it. The noise faded and faded, and then it was gone. No, I whispered into the quiet as the vapor began to thin. Oh, yes, a stallion said confidently, and I looked up to see a wall of brood, harbingers, and remnant surrounding us, guns motionlessly pointed at me. Looking down at me sat the Legate, his eyes narrowed in mirth. Time to die. Then his chest exploded. The harbingers opened up on him, the brood, and the remnant with full automatic spray. Indeed, only the flesh wall of the brood kept the three of us from being wiped out. The Legate jerked and danced in the air as if he were being electrocuted. But he didn't fall. Bullets sparked off the skull helmet. The remnant, the smallest in number of the three, fell back, and from around us came sounds of gunfire as the Harbingers attacked the Legate's forces all across the field. From above, the energy blasts from the Blizzard's secondary weapons lanced down, careful to hit the remaining three rockets, as the Zero exchanged fire with the Rampage and Cyclone. Fierce as the Harbingers were, though, the Brood still turned to face them. They didn't register pain, couldn't feel fear. Only a headshot or blasting them to pieces would really stop them. And now the ones on the field had a particularly nasty weapon. The rifles they employed, glowing blue bullets, that reminded me of Aspero's freezing powder. The enchanted rounds coated the Harbinger's barding with thick ice, froze their hooves to the ground, and, more than once, made huge chunks of flesh shatter off like meaty popsicles. And the Legate didn't stop either. The gory nightmare rushed right up to the first Harbinger to shoot him and took his right forelegs around the stallion's neck. The blood-streaked Legate twisted and pulled. The stallion's body gave a crack, then his entire head came off. Again, the Legate lunged at the next and the next, killing them all with crushing blows that shattered ribs and burst blood vessels. Bullets tumbled out of his body seconds after they entered. Bits shot off returned to rejoin his body. The field erupted into comprehensible chaos as the three of us collapsed into one of the shelter pits. Really, I didn't see why it was so full of shoulder-deep cold water, whether that was intentional or not, But after the baking we just received, it was quite refreshing. Rusty breathing apparatuses hung on hooks. There was a button for an emergency hatch, but despite mashing my hoof against it repeatedly, it wouldn't close. The shooting went on for several seconds, and I poked my head up. The Legate stood in a field of carnage. Most of the brood and all the harbingers had been within his reach had died. The remnant were beginning to emerge from gaps and cover, though most of them looked as if they wanted to be somewhere else but here. I couldn't blame them as the Legate stood in the middle of all that gore. He then turned to us in the shelter pit.
"Come on out, little fraud. Don't make me come in there after you."
Okay. Here's hoping he was in a talky mood. I whispered instructions to P21 and Scotch Tape, then climbed from the pit, water streaming from me as I faced him.
"Starkattery," I said,
and instantly his eyes narrowed.
"Oh, an educated fraud, or perhaps proof that my treacherous mate is working with the damned city,"
he said loudly, pointing a bloody hoof at me.
"Well, no matter. Soon the city will be destroyed, and the world purged of pony evil. I have sent the maiden back to the moon, and there she will remain forever. Should she return, I will annihilate her."
Why was he talking? He should just be killing me. But he'd been the same earlier, as well. He had phenomenal power to kill with his own hooves, and it wasn't enough. "You missed your calling, Amadi. You should have been an actor." Slowly, I walked to the left, all eyes on me, and none on the Filian stallion rushing away to the other side. He froze, his eyes wide behind the skull.
"You heard me, Amadi. You've been playing roles for centuries now. You use the war to cover up your schemes. You use the pony and zebra hate to play one against the other. You've been doing it for years now."
I narrowed my eyes and grinned at him as Scotch Tape and P21 went to work next to a heap of bodies behind him. "I was wrong. Not an actor."
"You're a politician."
His eyes narrowed this time.
"Who do you think you are? A mayor with a dyed mane who thinks to rally this pitiful resistance?"
he said as he gestured with a hoof at the gape to the west.
"You think you know me? You know nothing."
"I know it was you at Littlehorn," I said as I stood there, a perfect target, keeping the distance between me and him, as Scotch Tape and P21 frantically smeared bloody streaks across the flight deck. "You brought the pink cloud talisman, wired it with star metal to boost it. The more that died, the more it killed. Pretty effective," I said, with as much contempt in my voice as I could muster. "I know you grabbed golden blood and fell to the ground floor, then unleashed the talisman. You killed so many. And of course, afterwards, both sides blamed each other." His lips quivered behind the dragon's teeth. I had to guess that he was like golden blood, that he had a desperate need to vent all his accomplishments. Then his mouth split wide into a grin.
"It went marvelously, did it not? Better than I could have ever planned. Then the fire in Hoofington. I wanted to torch Ponyville personally, but there were too many soldiers in the way."
He laughed sharply, and an echo of wonder 2 centuries old in his voice as he went on.
"But Celestia abdicate her throne, and Luna taking it? I couldn't have planned that in 10,000 years.
The other zebra looked on, muttering to each other as the Liga continued to stare at me.
"But it's been hard," he continued. "You almost had the tokamak activated, didn't you? So close to Luna turning it on. Let me guess, the next plan was to raise it to the surface? Get the moonstone to it, then?"
His smile began to fade.
"How?"
And his pupils began to constrict.
"No,"
he hissed at me. "The bomb's falling really did ruin everything for you, didn't it? Let me guess. You planned on Luna winning, and then you'd use her dream of a strong, futuristic Equestria to cover what you were doing. You'd keep your exploits in the shadows till you could achieve your goal. But everything fell apart. I grinned at him. Ashur probably didn't like that, did he? All that hard work, wasted. And you're nothing if not persistent. Use the wasteland. Use the hoof. Use the remnant. Use Cognidium. And then, when I stepped out with EC-1101, everything started moving again. Horizons got ready to fire. Cognidium started to move. And you had your golden opportunity. Delegate took a step back from me.
That is impossible. You can't be. You're a fake. You're nothing. You're dead.
Dead. I threw back my head and laughed. I've died 3 times, and it hasn't stuck yet. I've destroyed goddesses and purged abominations from the land. I've broken the skies and cast down towers. I've stood in the middle of the mouth of the Eater of Souls and walked out again. I pointed my hoof at him and cried out, I'm the Maiden of the Stars, Amadi. Say my name. His eyes bulged, as if he were in a grip of a magic spell. Say it! I ordered.
Blackjack,
he whispered as if fighting to assimilate the idea. Then his eyes narrowed and he shook his head, never taking his eyes off me.
No, no, it cannot be. Impossible,
he said, his eyes tightening in horror. He pointed a hoof at me.
Kill her! Now!
But not one moved against me. I saw more bars turn yellow than stayed red. Shoot me, and be forever cursed, I warned, watching more bars turn yellow.
You are not the Maiden! She's gone to the stars!
His eyes dug into me. Not yet, I haven't, I countered. I raised my hoof as I saw P-21 finish painting and signal me with a hoof wave. I swallowed, glad he couldn't see me sweat. If this didn't work, and there were so many ways it could fail, he'd stop talking and start trying to take me apart. I raised my hoof over my head. Now, as Maiden of the Stars, I call on the skies to strike you down and smite you. I paused, swallowing. Right now. The shock melted away into a smoldering rage. Any second, I said as I glared upwards.
Now, damn it!
Idiot, he said in disgust as he turned from me. I watched those yellow bars turning back to red as he said contemptuously,
Kill her.
Then he froze as he stared at the ground between him and the letters LEGATE, written 10 feet tall, inside the crimson arrow pointing right at him. There was a resounding choom, and he disappeared in a blinding beam of light. I fell hard on my ass, wondering which airship had taken the shot. I'd kiss them all if we made this through it, though. Even Afterburner and Hoarfrost. I blinked repeatedly to try and clear the line of vision. Where was the Legate? I saw a blackened form in the middle of the patch, 20 feet away. Then I heard a scream. The inarticulate scream rising higher and higher as the body reared on its hind legs in a scorched circle. A blackened silhouette of charred meat pulling itself back together. An aceration disc of dust swirled around it, drawing back into its body, and everyone watched in horror as the charred carcass was wrapped in muscle and organs, then blood and skin. The blackened skull tumbled from its head and bounced around its hooves. When it ended, the Legate stood there, his black stripes now vivid, blood red, his face covered in the satellite pattern of the Sarkatery for all to see. Smoke rose all around him as he turned, and stared right at me with all the malice in the world in his gaze.
It is true,
muttered one of the remnant soldiers.
Sarkatery.
Almost unanimously, the remaining red bars turned yellow.
True! True!
He gaped at the remnant as they turned from her. He gestured to me.
She is our enemy! She will destroy all we have worked to achieve!
Kill her! He ordered. I stared at him in bafflement. Why the heck wasn't he popping my head off personally, like he had the others? Then it struck me. You're afraid to fight me, I said, a smile creeping across my face. That's it, isn't it? I stepped towards him and watched as he took a step back. It's not just Xanth and Lancer, is it? You're afraid of me too. You're afraid I'm the real thing, even if you thought you'd made the prophecy up. And even though you're an immortal beast, you're afraid I can stop you, I said as I advanced, watching him fall back. And best of all, if you're afraid I can, then there's a way. More and more remnant were emerging, and baffled, battered harbingers were showing themselves as well, the ponies looking around as if not sure what they should do now. Had they finally gotten the same message that Nails had given the other harbinger groups? Or were they simply realizing that they were in over their heads? Kill her! He screamed. And there was a long pause. And then, as one, the remnants raised their weapons. At him. It is over, father, Lancer said from one of the clumps. He stepped out with his sniper rifle. Sakashi and Majina were at his flanks, the filly repeating him silently to her mother. Surrender. Over. He seemed to mull the word over in his head. Give up, just like that, and let be left with nothing? He gave a little smile and a nod of his head. No, I've pursued this for thousands of years. I will never surrender.
Give up, Amadi. She has your name. She is foolish to continue, Sakashi said flatly. 1,000 years of folly weigh heavily, but redemption starts with a single choice.
He licked his lips, his red eyes desperate as he looked at me, then the zebras and harbingers around him. For several seconds he stared at me, and I tried to give it up. Do better. Find a good way. It would be wonderful, wouldn't it? No more plotting, no more desperation, no more fear. Peace. I approached him. It can still be that way. He seemed to relax and give a little nod, and for an instant, I smiled too and extended a hoof towards him. Then his arms snapped out and seized it, and his eyes locked with mine. For a second, I thought there might be a chance. Some shred of equanimity that I could appeal to. And I realized that I'd finally dared to forgive too far. Thousands of years of hatred, war, blood, and more thundering behind his eyes in an unending storm. He twisted the limb almost completely around, and fire bloomed as I heard bones snapping and joints popping.
Fool! He spat at me as I fell.
Lancer shot his father, the leagued speed nearly carrying him clear of the bullet, but the blow still ripping away half his head and spinning him away from me. The blood and blown spray slowed and turned as P-21 and Scotch Tape dragged me away from the mad zebra. As his eye regenerated and his head reassembled, he proclaimed,
I still have the brood, and it is a mighty army, greater than all of you together. As we speak, that fool is traveling to the moon. She carries the soul of the true maiden within her, and without that, you cannot defeat the Eater of Souls. This world is done.
P-21 pulled me to Sakashi and Majina. My leg was twisted around, the pain so sharp and real that I almost wished I had my old body back. More and more zebras and ponies tried to shoot the Legate, but their bullets didn't begin to seriously inconvenience him as he reassembled himself again and again. Ow, 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 I repeated over and over. Sakashi didn't waste any time. She grabbed my hoof and twisted it the opposite way. Again, the leg let out a number of pops, grinds, and snaps that nearly knocked me completely out. Then she jammed a bright purple potion in my mouth, and I chugged for all I was worth. Majina was giving Scotch Tape loads of precious little purple bottles. I had a sick certainty that I'd need them.
Brood! Destroy them all! Kill everything! Kill it all! He cried out. And destroy these rockets!
From the bodies on the ground came a rasp as they began to rise. The large doors set in the walls creaked open, and out came a surge of brood flyers and cyber zebras. The defenders in the gap suddenly reversed, turning inward and rushing forward. There were only 3 rockets left on the pads. If they took out all 3... Crap, I muttered as I rose to my hooves. He really doesn't like the maiden, does he? I said to Sakashi, trying to sprint to the nearest launch pads. You are not the maiden, she said. You are the fool. Gee, thanks, I said with a roll of my eyes, tears running down my cheeks as my legs still zinged. I drank another healing potion. It is not an insult. The fool terrifies, because not even the fool knows what they can do. They gamble against odds no other would dare. They dance at the very edge of the precipice because they can. They overcome where all others stupendously fail. Tyrants have always feared the fool, for they bring disaster and suffering for their plans. They are heroes without parallel, and monsters without equal, because they do what they will, and damn the plans of others. We started moving towards the closest rocket. A Starkattery mayor called me the gambler, though, I said, with a little bafflement. She gave a smile. They are one and the other. The fool plays at odds no wise person would dare. They are minions of chance, agents of chaos, and tools of discord. Then what is the maiden? I asked, making sure she could see my lips. Hope for some and despair for others, she replied. She breaks bonds and ruins fortunes. She challenges and overcomes, and breaks her enemies. She is, like the stars themselves, a catalyst. Keep her at rest, for should she act. It will mean joy for some and terror for others, and none can say which for whom, she said gravely. I have many stories about both, but I fear that there is no time for them now, Blackjack. She sighed and looked around. It is a bad day when there is no time for stories. Yeah, I know the feeling, I replied. Then I caught her gaze again. The League of the Balefire missile aimed at this place. You need to get the remnant out, as far from here as you can. We will see you on your way first, she said, and then she turned and started to speak in rapid-fire tongues to the other zebras. I stood and looked up at the nearest rocket. Gambler and fool, huh? That suits me just fine. Annie up. There were brood between me and my rocket, and I had a squad of zebra commandos at my flank. Together, we charged in. The cyber zebras were trying to duct tape explosives to the booster, but precision snipers were blowing holes in their heads before they could. I made it as far as the base of the launcher tower before there was a loud ping and a whoosh, a short jet puff of white vapor shooting from the side of the rocket. Alarms began to sound as more bullets punched more holes, vapor jetting from some, liquid dropping from others. Dozens, hundreds. Eventually ones were punched too large or jagged to seal shut on their own. Brood rushed in, grenades gripped in their mouths as they continued to fire. I grabbed P-21 and scotch tape and we fled. The bulwark fields rose up just before one of the boosters tore itself into a storm of shrapnel and fire that disintegrated any brood caught inside and called the other 3 boosters to join it. The bulwark protected us from the devastation and the fireball rising into the night, but the twisted wreck hidden by the smoke wouldn't be flyable again. 1 down, 2 left. I didn't waste any time. The emergency field died within a few minutes, spilling fuel flames across the flight pad. Most of it had gone up, but there was still plenty of fire. Don't let the brood take this one out! I yelled as we pelted towards the next nearest launch pad. The snipers opened up and picked off the brood racing towards us. We made it to the launcher tower without a problem, and I sprinted up the stairs. Up, 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 up! I shouted as P-21 and Scotch Tape climbed after me. Blackjack, look out! Boo shouted from below. I stared down at where the blank mare stood up at me.
Tank!
She shouted, pointing a hoof to the side. I leaned out and spotted the tank that had been in a gap rolling through the wreckage of the rocket. Thankfully, one of the ones that had already been ruined when we arrived. It swiveled its cannon towards us. Down, 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 down! I shouted, as we all but fled down the stairs in our haste. There wasn't any way we could get across the bulwark before it fired. Then blue dust whirled around it, coated it with a glowing blizzard of magic. Ice began to form, and I stopped. Maybe... I looked back up at the rocket hatch. Then the tank fired, the shockwave shattering the ice on its front. The shell gouged deep lines in the flight pad. Down! Definitely down! I screamed as the frost-rimmed turret began to elevate. The magic might be slowing it down, but I didn't doubt that it would fire. We hit the flight deck and ran for our lives. The tank fired again. The base of the rocket blossomed into flame. I jumped, rolling across the talisman movement moments before the bulwark rose. Mostly. When the tank shell had torn the pad, it had crossed the circle of talismans. The thin, dim field across the gap held for a split second, then yielded. A river of fire, hotter and wider than the breath of a dozen dragons, poured out and washed over the tank. Even on this side of the rocket, I could feel the cyclone-like glush of the blazing heat. The tank didn't stand a chance. It exploded like a firecracker in a flamethrower's scream. When the entire fire-fused mass of the rocket and launch structure gave a whine and slowly kneeled over. I hit the weakened side of the bulwark, and the field began to fade. Running! Keep running! I yelled. The bulwark collapsed, and the entire Fleming wreck tipped over on the tank. The explosion sent Fleming bits all over the pad, and our pitbucks were clicking like mad as the rad rate doubled. And doubled again! What next? Remnant and Harbinger alike fled from the rain of flaming debris. I'm already tired of this day, I groaned. Boo rushed up to me, throwing her hooves around me. Hi, Boo, I said lightly. How are you doing? She blinked at me a moment.
I'm fine. I found a Reaper pony with a thingy, and he said he'd tell everyone to get the fuck away.
She made a scrunchy face as she glared towards the gap.
Reapers are really rude.
I nuzzled her ear and pulled myself to my hooves. Well, glad you're back. I struggled to see the last rocket through the heat and haze and steam. Sweat soaked my barding, though I was wiped the droplets from my eyes. It rested on its pad, our last hope to getting to Cognitium. There were fiery bits all around it, and burning on the launch tower. Come on, I said as I rose to my hooves and started towards it, trying to get past the burning pools of fuel that were now spattered all around the flight deck. Here and there, ruptured fuel lines gushed gouts of fire into the air. The emergency shutoffs must not have been working too well. Of course, they'd be the things that fail. We crossed the central pad, one of the few places that weren't on fire, Boo scooping scotch onto her back, after seeing the smaller mare struggling to keep up as we made our way to the base of the gantry. I stepped in, something that looked like steaming water, only to have ice immediately form on my barding's boot hoof. When I staggered back, too close to a burning chunk of metal, the whole leg burst into flame for a few seconds before I could swap out the barding. Funny, I never imagined that there was a place worse than Hightower. Fire, explosions, building radiation. All that was missing was Smooze. We'd lost our zebra escorts in the second explosion, but it looked like the brood were dwindling. He might have an endless supply of them, but that didn't mean he had all of them here. Between the Harbingers, the Remnant, and their self-destructive attacks, it was abundantly clear that they weren't lasting long. That was just out here, though. I looked up at the window of the control room and saw flashes of gunfire and energy beams. We had to get into the rocket and get her out of there. Why had we separated? Why hadn't I stayed behind to guard the command center? But I was the only mare. I couldn't do it all myself. No pony could. The third and last rocket was still intact, and I thought for a moment that I'd finally beaten the odds. But as I got close, I heard the strangest humming. And when I put my hooves on the metal steps, I could feel them vibrating beneath me. I stared up the stairs and spotted the Legate halfway up. His forehooves were a blur as he pounded them against the thick steel beams in the tower. A normal pony would be beating their hooves to nubs under that pounding, but of course his regenerating body would never succumb to injury. Nor would he tire. But what was he trying to do? There was a sharp ping, and a rivet near the bottom of the gantry popped open. As I watched, the bolts were turning slowly in their sockets as the vibration only grew more and more intense. I remembered how the League had fought, his blows disturbing the energy in the body. The gantry was just one enormous body, and he was adding more and more energy to it, resonating it with the perfect frequency to shake it apart. "Go!" I shouted as I tried to rush up the stairs. My hooves were sliding and humming under me as I struggled up to where he pummeled the metal. Welds cracked, and one step fell away under my hoof as I put weight on it. The humming reminded me of the monotone note of enervation. I felt an ominous sway start as we made our way next to him. I didn't even hesitate. I readied Sexy and charged him, if only to break his rhythm. Only then did I realize how infuriated Scotch Tape must have been, a fighting Pythia, as his rear hoof deftly kicked my gun aside and smashed my temple, the blow sending me to the vibrating deck. P21 looked at Persuasion, did something to the grenade in the breech, then fired it at the Legate. The grenade stuck to him like a solid iron hoof ball, knocking him under the girder he'd been pummeling. The grenade, however, didn't detonate, simply bounced and rattled to the catwalk floor. He loaded a second, took aim once more, and fired. This time the Legate kicked out, the limb folding like snapped wood, and deflecting the shot, only to pop back and out again. The red-striped zebra sneered at P21. "Futile." "Lashbang," he replied. The Legate immediately covered his face. I wasn't going to waste this opportunity. Two three-round bursts sent him flipping out over the railing. One hoof grabbed the gantry, but a third burst blew the limb off at the shoulder. As he fell, I glanced down at the grenade. "Dud?" I asked with a frown.
"No. I just trusted him to know more about flashbangs than you," P21 replied casually, as he picked up the grenade and tossed it over the edge.
For a brief moment, I wondered if I'd been insulted or not, but I really didn't have time to ponder the issue. "Scotch, is this thing going to stay up?" I asked as I feeling the still humming gantry.
"Shh, shh,
please stay up," I said, as if trying to hush the humming, swaying structure. There were still little pops and pings and new groans, too. I became aware that the whole immense structure was starting to lean sideways.
"I don't think so, Blackjack,"
Scotch Tape shouted as the rocket began to make a metallic groan of protesting.
"Run!"
"No, we can't! It's the last one!" I shouted, starting up the steps. P21 grabbed me and pulled me back.
"And that won't mean anything if we die when the tower collapses."
I stared up at the inviting hatch for several seconds, the boarding catwalk already slowly scraping away from it across the rocket's skin, then turned and followed Boo down the stairs. The tower leaned further and further over, and we finally had to leap the last 10 feet. Don't lock legs, roll with the landing. Good lessons. I looked up and back to see the tower fall sideways, away from the rocket. Maybe it would still work. And then the tower hit one of the launch clamp supports, and I saw that the opposite one was already lying in pieces on the launch pad. The support twisted under the weight of the tower. The clamp, still attached to the rocket, pulled it away from the other two, and the great ship crumbled into the middle and toppled, smashing into pieces and a great pool of steaming liquid on the ground. "Maybe we can fix it," I muttered as we backed away. Then the pools exploded, the bulwark going up and slicing the rocket in two, just in time to save us from frying. I looked at the still-open, now-deformed hatch in the rocket's upper half as we hastened away from the flames, just in case the bulwark had been damaged by the fall. The last rocket, the last chance to stop Cognitium. The entire world had grown oddly silent. I staggered away. reaching the intercom box on some machine I couldn't identify and sat down hard. With no way to stop Cognitium, and no folly, there was no way I could win. I pressed my head to the warm metal, trying to abate the throbbing in my head.
What now?
Petronian asked. Now? I don't know, I answered, unable to look at him. There was a crackle on the intercom.
Blackjack,
Glory said, with the sounds of gunshots being shot behind her. Apparently, there were still brood that hadn't gotten the memo they'd won. Get out of here, Glory. It's over. Maybe little Pip could park the SPP hub in the path of Tom, if that was possible.
No, it's not. Get to pad one.
I frowned and looked across the pad next to the stairs. It was one of the rockets I assumed had been destroyed in the fueling, the one covered in ice. But now, it was covered in zebras.
Sirtanus and the other Popoli are getting it ready to fly. They've already fixed the problem that stopped it last time. You just have to keep the Legate from attacking it long enough for them to get the oxygen tanks filled. They're doing it now.
Hope, terrible and wonderful hope, stirred in me. Keep him busy, I said as I rose to my hooves.
Yeah, I can do that.
I could see a sole remaining red bar on my EFS, out in the middle of the launch pads. I made sure my magazines were topped off, put on my helmet, and started walking. The Legate stood in the middle of a circle of rockets as the flames danced all around the launch pad. His blood-red stripes seemed to glow with the light that shone, the roaring glare and chaos that reigned around him. Brood against Harbringers, remnants against brood. In the eye of the madness, in the center of the grated hole of the ESS-A1 launch pad, thin, warm steam rising around him, was the striped stallion. And he was laughing. It was a joyous laugh. A rolling, ragged, elated laugh, finally free of the constraints of discipline. Like a slurry of madness and hateful delight was pouring out of him. And he spread his hooves wide and whirled. Head thrown back, mane snapped in the wind, tearing around the launch pad. He shrieked in glee, reveling in the slaughter all around him. He wasn't killing just a single pony or zebra himself. He celebrated like a child who's successfully destroyed a deep friendship out of petty spite because he had no such solace. I stepped into the grate with him, the wind whipping my black and red mane as I stood there, facing him.
Beautiful, isn't it?
He asked, his back towards me.
You have no idea how long I have been waiting for this day.
I was done with witty repertoire. Sardonic retorts. I answered him with a storm of lead. His spiritually fortified body jerked and spasmed in a dance of bloody spray and meaty chunks as the slugs tore into pieces. Yet again, the bloody bits reversed direction in the air and returned to his body as soon as they were separated. The red streaked hide reassembled before my eyes, facing me, his smirk rematerializing before me. So I smashed the gun across his face. He whirled around, but this time I reversed my swing immediately, keeping the metal between him and me, and he slammed his foreleg against the stout barrel. I was rewarded with the sight of his foreleg bending like clay around the metal with a cracking noise like snapped plywood, but even more satisfying was the look of shock on his face. Pity that expression disappeared for an instant later as I blasted away his face.
Futile,
he rasped from a shattered, reforming throat. But I didn't stop. Even without eyes, he had an uncanny ability to strike back at me. His left hind hoof pistoned into my face. I staggered back, the blow making my head throb and vision blur for several seconds. But I didn't stop my delay, pushing through the pain to spray the full-auto fan of lead in his direction. Most missed, but the hail of rounds took his hooves out from under him and gave me a second to refocus. I made like a zebra. Shoulder the gun, braced it with a hoof, and bathed him with fiery lead. His head, torso, liquefied under the barrage, and then the drum went dry.
I looked down into the bloody ruin of his chest cavity and saw his heart. It reminded me of the Phoenix Talisman, but carved from a dark stone. Spiritual runes and zebra glyphs decorated its surface. Attached to it was what looked like a pipbuck broadcaster made of star metal. Red and green lights flashed on it, with spikes wired directly into the stone. I slapped in another drum, and unloaded a burst right into that accursed rock. The shots bounced off wildly, scraping tissue off the heart's surface, but no faster than it was regenerating. One ricochet even slammed into my barding. Finally, I reached in with a hoof and tried to pry the star metal device from the smooth stone. But not only did I fail, the reassembling gore threatened to trap my hoof in his chest. I yanked my leg free, crimson streaming behind it, and pulled back. Of course, it had to be a soul jar. Flesh surged back into the hole I'd left, reattaching and reassembling itself around that silvery box and stone. "Glory is going to die," he gurgled through his face, ripped in two by my firepower. "Right now, I am sending every brood I have to blast her to pieces. I might have them play with her a little. Initiate her into yours and P-21's little club." His face reformed enough to make a leer. I did the only sensible thing that I could in that situation. I reloaded. "Blackjack!" P-21 snapped as he emerged from the smoke and haze, holding me and stopping me from turning the Leagate into paint again. "He's stalling you!" "I don't care!" I snapped, aiming at him once more with a sooty scotch tape and Boo emerging from the well as well.
"Oh, but you do care. You care," the Leagate hissed at me
as he sprang casually to his hooves and we started to circle.
"Shoot me. Shoot me all you can. Maybe you'll find a way, Falciero. Some way to end me. Some trick. Some gamble. That's why you are here, after all. Dice thrown by higher powers in a desperate attempt to change a future that is immutable and irrefutable. You care so much that it makes you pain."
Then the lead exploded, the lump of rock and gore bouncing across the grate.
"He talks too much," P-21 said as he lowered persuasion, then turned to me. "Blackjack, he's stalling you. He knows we're trying to stop Horizons. Fighting him is doing what he wants."
I blinked at him, then over at the reconstructed lump of pure, unadulterated bastard.
"You can't shoot evil to death, Blackjack. You just have to do better."
"Let's go, Blackjack,"
Boo nodded.
"We've got bigger things to do,"
Scotch Tape agreed. I slowly approached and stared down at him, his spine appearing fused to the pieces, pulling themselves back together again. His eyes reformed, glittering with malice, spite. I couldn't just walk away from him. Not after all he'd done. Not after all he'd hurt. I knelt down, seeing where his body was trying to reform through the launchpad grate. I stared right into his eyes, and said the one word I was sure would get him like no other. "Discord." My lips curled into a smile. The mirth and malice disappeared as he stared at me. I rose, delighting in the opportunity to see my foe in mental anguish. He was a heady drug.
"No," he said. "No, you can't. He didn't. You can't be. You were broken."
He spat as his pupils shrank.
"The stars never lie."
"So? Not the first time I've been put back together again," I said coolly. "And now I'm going to stop her, stop Tom, and stop you. Because Discord convinced Cognitium to take my soul and put it into this blank."
"No, it is impossible,"
he roared up at me, all mirth gone.
"You're trapped
here.
Discord to do it. Uncle Discord saved Blackjack,"
Boo said with a fond smile.
"Even if he had to die, he did it."
Funny how much love one mare's eyes could have for one of Equestria's villains. I couldn't say I didn't feel the same way.
"Blackjack?"
Petronilin warned. Still, I couldn't help myself. See that rocket? That frosty one? Turns out it still works. I checked Sexy's magazine coolly, then slept back into place. I'm going to get my body back, and not you, not Cognitium, not even the stars will stop me. I started to turn away when a thought occurred to me. Hey, Amati, when I put my mind back into my old body, guess I really will be the Maiden of the Stars, at least for a little while. Funny, huh? That the prophecy you made up will actually come true? And I turned and started away, a satisfying smile on my face. Gloating might be a terrible habit, but damn, it felt good. Then he screamed. It wasn't a scream like a pony could make, or a beast. It was more the harrowing howl of a feral ghoul, devoid of any sanity, ripping from a throat indifferent to injury. An expression of such rage and fury that it encompassed every aspect of the note. If that scream could be weaponized, it would have rivaled a balefire bomb for its fury. You're dead! All of you! Everything! Dead! 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 He ranted as he struggled. For several seconds he went on like that. Then he went silent. I froze, turning to see him watching me. His eyes were wide, wild, but a smile rested on his face. A look of triumph. Dead, he stated, low and certain. But what could he do? He was just making idle threats. The idle threats of a trapped lunatic. He probably had lost his mind. And yet? Yet, what could he do? I didn't see any brood charging the field. He was stuck. So what? What? That device, the thing he'd wired to his heart, that had to be how he controlled the brood, and maybe much more. Our eyes locked, and I saw such malice it stunned me. He'd use anything to kill me. Anything at all. Oh, shit. You're going to use the missile, I whispered. His eyes narrowed as his smile widened. Time seemed to slow as our eyes met, and that moment of clarity and understanding joined us. The noise, the battle, the Legate suddenly didn't matter. We have to go. Now. Right now. We raced towards launch pad number one. The rocket was a dingy little sliver of gray, sheets of ice still dangling from its sides, and the girders of its support structures. It was half the size of the others, but now it was my last, best hope. A dozen zebras worked to attach hoses and banging off the ice. From behind me, I heard the moan of bending metal and a wet rip of rending meat. I dared to glance back and saw in horror the muscles in the Legate's forelegs bulging as he pushed himself out of the grate, the bars tearing lengths of his body off, even as the force of his flesh tried to regenerate beneath them. Cerintis met us at the foot of the tower. You made it, he said as he brushed the frost off his brow. He waved a hoof at the rocket. There was a catastrophic failure in the LOX hoses and the pumps at safeties on the first loading. We wrote that rocket off, given it was the oldest model that we had, that we could make work at all. First generation. The fuel is loaded, we've nearly finished that last time, and there's nothing wrong with their system. I nodded. Listen, the Legate has a balefire missile, right? The zebra gulped. He's fired it. Fired it? He gaped at me, looking around wildly. We have to go. Now. Right now. That wasn't the response I wanted. How long? I asked. I do not know. With the missiles we had, if the crews back at Dawn Bay were slacking, 15 minutes? Much more if they had the fuel first. But if the missile was ready to fire, fly 5? Less? And how long ago did he fire? I swallowed and looked up at the rocket. Okay. Soon as you can, get out of here. I don't want any of you dying if I can help it. I looked out the window of the control center, but it was dark. It's a minute between starting the launch sequence and taking off, right? About that. He nodded in agreement, then turned and started shouting thanks to the zebras working in the rocket. From the urgency in his voice, I had little doubt they knew this was coming down to the wire. Boo! I called as I turned to them. I had to trust her luck. You had to find Big Daddy and Lancer. Tell them that the missile is on its way, now.
I don't want to go with you,
Boo wailed.
I just got back.
If you don't, hundreds are going to die, I said as I turned and faced her. I need you to do it. You're the only one lucky enough to pull it off. I pulled her close and gave her a fierce hug. You're a big girl, Boo. I'm so proud of you. Now, go find them. Get them out of here as fast as you can. Boo hugged me back and sniffled.
Come back quick, Mama. Come back safe.
And then she was gone, running back as quick as she could. Scotch tape! Get in the cockpit! Do your best to figure out what we need to do to get into the sky. She gaped at me. I know you don't have a cutie mark of a missile, but there's gotta be some instructional manual or something.
Blackjack, I can't read a manual for a rocket ship in 3 minutes,
she protested. I tapped her pipbuck. Use sats. It should buy you a little extra time. She made more faintly struggling noises. I know you can do this, Scotch. And hey, if you mess up, no one's going to be able to tell you that you did. So get it right. P-21 then installed some kind of terminal in these and make them fly. Make sure it's working.
What are you going to do?
There was a thud as the Leggett landed next to us. His back was a grisly jumble of steel and flesh. Buy you time, I said. Hurry.
You have no time to buy,
the Leggett shouted as my friends ran. Then he launched himself at me once more, just as quick as before, but now filled with dreadful urgency. He went into his usual blinding flourishes of kicks and stomps, spinning this way and that, but I'd seen his technique. Felt it, too. And I knew it was all about circles and momentum. I refused him any momentum. I used sexy like a shield, holding it vertically in my magic for him to break his hooves against. And his bent hooves, bones, jutting from the limb, pulled the weapon aside so he could smash his face against mine. It didn't matter how my horn gouged him. He had everything to lose if he didn't kill me or stop that rocket. The impact nearly broke my horn, sending an ice pick of pain right into my skull and making my eyes water and vision blur. I had taken 3 steps back when his rear hoof swept mine out from under me, dropping me hard on my back, before leaping down and smashing my guts and ribs with an extended hind leg. I managed to snag his leg and roll, knocking him on his back beside me as I struggled to suck in a single breath. But he sprang back up to his hooves the moment he touched down. I pushed the burning feedback in my horn and blasted him in the face with 3 sats-guided magic bullets. As he staggered away, I chugged 2 healing potions at once, feeling my ribs popping back into place beneath my barding. Before his face could fully regenerate, I smashed the bottles between my hooves and telekinetically flung the shards into it. I figured glass inside regenerating eyeballs had to count for something, and it did. His brows were now off by inches. I now simply focused on not getting hit. He whirled, his legs whistling as it almost took my head off more than once. I gave ground and did all I could not to block. Then he switched from spinning kicks and punches to a forward lunge, grabbing my face and headbutting again. I felt skull grind against the tip of my horn before I was knocked on my back yet again. He arched up with a jagged spur of metal, and as little P-21s danced in my vision, I watched him rip the eyes from his sockets and mash them between his hooves. A second later, a bloody splur swept back up and reformed them. He tossed the bits of broken glass at my hooves as I stared up at him.
Even without augmentations, you fight well, he said as his eyes narrowed.
Then he turned his head and looked at the porpoise trying to get the rockets ready to fly.
They don't.
He raced towards the rocket as I rolled to my hooves. If only I could teleport. Instead, I slipped into sats and targeted one of his hind legs. Two magic bullets blasted it off halfway, but the stallion barely broke stride. I grabbed the dismembered leg with my magic as it slowly started to return, wrapping my hooves around the length and letting it drag me after him. As the leg reattached itself, I pressed Sexy to his pelvis and fired a full-auto spray of buckshot right into his torso. The leg exploded again. I rolled twice, then ran to the base of the rocket.
Hurry!
I yelled at them as the Legat rose to his hooves. If that Balefire missile was on its way, I was already dead. That rocket was my only hope, and he was charging straight at it. I got in his way, unable to dodge and keep him back at the same time, and tried to block one swinging hoof with Sexy's reinforced barrel. I succeeded, but he grabbed the gun with his hind leg, swung back, striking me in the head so hard I heard something crack, and suddenly saw three of them. Then he dove past me at the hoses marked LOX dangling from the launch structures. I didn't dare shoot, so I did the only thing I could. I bit down hard on his tail, lifting my forelegs to block the double kick to my face. Bones in my forelegs cracked at the impact. Still, I kept my grip, struggling to pull him back from the rocket. The Rapporti were now fleeing for their lives, moving down into maintenance spaces at the base of the wall. The leader ran into the intercom and shouted into it, "Miss Glory, is everything green?"
"Yes, Pad 1 is green."
More gunshots over the intercom.
"You need to hurry,"
she said.
"Wheel, lever, wedge, Miss Glory,"
he said, as if the words were a benediction of some sort, and then he turned and left as well. It was now between me and the Legate. He might have been extremely strong, but even he couldn't tear off his own tail, no matter that it tasted blood in my mouth. My feet skidded as he pulled me closer to the hoses. My horn glowed as I swung the barrel sideways and knocked his feet out from under him.
"Blackjack!"
came Glory's voice over the loudspeaker. If I hadn't been dragging the Legate back, I would have cheered to hear her voice. Instead, I battered him with my shotgun as I tried to pull him away from the remaining rocket.
"I see you on the monitor, and a missile's coming."
Rapid-fire gunshots tore out of my pip-buck, and she cried out in pain.
"Please, hurry!"
His rear hoof hammered back, smashing my forelegs again, and I felt bones snapping. I needed a healing potion before he crippled me. I took a chance, released his tail, and gulped two down. Battered him with Sexy and pulled out two more, barely able to hold them with my fractured hooves. I had them half-drained when his hoofs smashed out and shattered them against my teeth. I screamed as my mouth tried to expel bloody glass while healing at the same time. My magic focus was lost, and I grabbed Sexy in my hooves and kept him down with the swings. The Legate grabbed the gun, and as I lifted, it pulled him up enough that he slammed his hooves against my horn, breaking my focus. Then he swung one of his forehooves across, tearing open my scalp under the compact spire. Blood dripped into my eyes as I finally released his tail and raised my forelegs to try and block him. But, now free, he dropped down and punched me hard in the gut. I vomited noisily onto the concrete and fell back, barely able to breathe. He raced straight for the rocket, reached over his shoulder, and ripped out a long strip of bloody shrapnel from his back. It dragged along the ground beside him, and my heart froze as I made out tiny gouts of flame flashing from the fuel soaking into the poured stone. All it needed to do was ignite a large enough volume, and we'd all go up. Then a blue cannonball landed right on his back, knocking them both to the ground and making him drop the metal bar. P-21 wasn't a fighter. He wasn't even all that big for a stallion, and he slammed his hooves into the Legate's head again and again, until it finally the zebra was forced to fight him off. With a wild toss, P-21 was sent flying, landing next to one of the hoses.
"Enough of this," the Legate shouted. "No more. No more plotting, no more scheming, no more fighting, no more wasting my time with this annoying, futile hope. I am the Chosen One, supreme, invincible."
He then snatched up the bar, the sharp, jagged edge glinting in the floodlights. hooking it in his hooves and raising it up for a downward swing on one of the hoses. I struggled to put together enough focus to try a magic bullet. For all I knew, it would ignite everything anyway. Then P21 grabbed one of the hoses near where it joined to a pipe on the tower and pulled it with all his might. The old tube, coated in frost, gave a ripping noise and suddenly popped free in a cloud of white. He turned and pointed it right at the red-striped zebra, bathing him in a stream of evaporating fluid. Some safety had to exist, because after several seconds, the flow cut off. The Liget stood there, bar overhead, a rime of frost covering him from head to hoof. I had to drink a healing potion just to see clearly, wiping the blood out of my eyes and spitting out a shard of glass stuck to my tongue. Then I approached the Liget. Some of the freezing fluid was still dripping down his body, and I could hear little cracks and pops. "Invincible this," I said, and swung the bar with all my strength. The Liget's limbs shattered, falling into a puddle of freezing fluids, breaking like a delicate figurine upon the ground. I rushed up to P21, trying to pull the hose away as it drooled cold steaming fluid. It took a great deal of his fur with it. The other things that I needed healing potions for. He shivered horribly against me.
"He talks too much,"
P21 muttered, ice dangling off his mane. "Come on," I said, not knowing how long we had before the Liget thawed or we were all fried. Levitating my gun, I put him on my back, carrying him up the spiraling gantry to the rocket's launch tower. "Glory, are you there?" I asked into my pitbuck as we reached the open hatch to the top. "As soon as you can, you need to start the launch sequence and get back here." I reached the hatch. "Glory?" "Got it," she said a little lighter than I'd liked. "Are you okay?" Magical interferers be damned. If the answer was no, I was going to break the laws of physics and magic to bring her back to safety.
"I'm fine, Blackjack," Glory said. "Hurry, you don't have long."
More gunshots sounded from the pitbuck. "I've started the pre-launch countdown already. It's all automated." "Good. Come straight away, okay?" I asked as I tried to ignore the shouts of shooting over the radio. I got P21 inside the much snugger interior of our rocket. There were just four passenger seats. The fifth, with the controls occupied by a cobbled-together terminal machine like the ones Cognitium's had in her rocket. I set him down in one and started buckling him in. Four small portholes along the wall and in the door let me see out.
"I'll try,"
Glory said quietly. That set alarms off in my head. More gunshots sounded, now from both my foreleg and the speaker in the capsule. I spotted a terminal showing the control room. Heaps of dust, dead zebras, and slain brood littered the place. Glory looked up from a terminal and smiled at the camera. Almost instantly, a unicorn brood teleported into the room. Glory immediately whirled at the flash, the beams of her guns lancing out and biting deep into it. Magic bullets slammed into her as her beams cut down the machine, the jacket absorbing most of the hits, but not all. Her wings and haunches wept with a dozen wounds. I rose to my hooves as Scotch Tape strapped herself in as well. "Hang tight! I'll be right there," I said as I started towards the door. It swung shut in my face. There was a sound of bolts being driven into the hatch with whirling noises. I slammed my hooves against the metal. "What's going on?" I shouted, slamming my hooves against it, looking around for a doorknob as I heard the bolt thunk shut. "Glory?" I looked out the window in the door, which pointed right at the large window of the control room. I could see flashes of light from inside.
"I can't leave, Blackjack. I don't know how to disable the controls. If I leave, they could abort the launch," she said,
my ears straining to catch her words over the rattle of gunfire. I rushed back to the terminal, watching as she hunkered over the terminal, blasting again and again. Back to the hatch, back to trying to figure out how to get the damn things open.
"Get out of there, Glory! We'll leave! Find another way!"
I yelled as I beat my hooves against the metal. There had to be some way.
"Open this thing, Scotch!"
I said, looking at all the knobs and levers. I whipped my head around and screamed. Open it right now! I have to get her! Scotch Tape stared at me. Tears streaked her cheeks as he stared from me to the shivering P21. Do it! I screamed at her.
No,
P21 said through chattering teeth. I'd do it for you, I yelled at him. I'd do it for you too, Scotch, I snapped at the stricken filly.
And she's doing it for you,
he answered, tears streaking the lingering frost on his cheeks.
Just like we would do it for you.
No, 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 no. I don't want anyone to die for me, I said, as I slammed my shoulder against the hatch. Where was the emergency open? Something. Glory! I sobbed. Blackjack? The missile will impact in a minute, Glory said calmly, glancing over at a display. I can see it here. There was a thunk and a hiss, whine and rattle sounded in the guts of the rocket. I've checked the flight path. You're going to get to the Lunar Palace a little bit behind Cognitium. My view of the control room was now briefly blocked by a moving beam as the launcher tower strung down and away from with the sound of klaxons. Please, Glory, please. I tried to teleport and hit the wall again. Tried again. Hit it again. Whatever Zebra talisman kept me back refused to yield. I levitated out the gun, pointing it at the hatch.
Don't! You'll kill us all!
Scotch yelled.
Blackjack,
P21 said in tones intended to help me accept the unacceptable. No, I shouted, my hooves beating against the metal. All systems nominal. Launch tower disengaged, a heartless computer stated coldly. Starting core engine stages. I wanted to slay the damn machine. It was the only thing that we could get me to my destination. I bit my lips so hard, trying not to scream, that I tasted blood. We can't just leave her. I reached out and put a hoof. P21 reached out and put a hoof on my shoulder. As the bulwark field activated around our rocket and the hiss beneath us turned into a roar. Core stage engine thrust stable. Booster ignition in 10. 9. 8.
No, Blackjack. It's that. I'm sorry.
He told me in tones that couldn't begin to console me, with words that didn't begin to make this right. He was also the only thread of sanity keeping me together. What was one life to that of the whole world? Everything. There was a price to be paid. I could accept that. What I could not accept was another person paying the price. I sobbed, looking out at Glory as she rose and turned to face out the window. Despite the distance that separated us, I could still make out her smile as she stared back at me. I saw her lips move, but the words were stolen by the dull roar blasting into a thunder. And the computer said something I didn't catch. Glory and the Space Center were gone from the window. I staggered over to the communications terminal against crushing pressure and the shaking of the world. I stretched a hoof towards the monitor as I saw her slump. There was blood in the corner of her mouth. One wing shot clean through and dangling beside her as if about to fall off. Out of the window behind her, I could see a column of magical fields vanishing as steam drifted over an empty launch pad. I collapsed to the floor, reaching towards her, straining my hoof to touch the screen. She placed hers over mine. Two ponies separated by a plane of cold glass. I stared, willing the glass to dissolve, for her to come back, tears streaking down my face. Blackjack, she murmured, smiling as she wept. Tomorrow. Outside the window, the world grew light, a sunrise from below. The monitor went dark, and I squeezed my eyes shut. Glory, beneath the floor. Glory meeting me in the shower. Glory's tears in the rain. Glory hovering beneath me. Hoof outstretched, aglow. I feel of Glory holding me. Glory saving Scotch Tape. Glory throwing me across the room as Dash. Glory dancing with me in her stunning dress. Glory flying through the skies with me. Glory giving me her speech to Thunderhead. Glory walking away. Glory giving me a sad smile. I threw my head back as I was crushed to the floor, crying out her name for the whole universe to hear. Lost in the roar as her sacrifice carried me into the heavens.